Well, we will, it's usually behind me, I guess. We'll say it anyway. Okay, thank you, everyone. Okay, first hiccup avoided. So, item number one, good to see you, Commissioner Spaulding. If you would not mind doing roll call, please.
I not only would not mind, I would be delighted. Happy New Year, everybody. Good to see everyone. Vice Chair Freeman.
Cheerfully here.
And Chairperson, Commissioner Turley. Tim Curley. Hi.
Hi.
Good evening. Helene Silver is excused. Commissioner Keyser.
Present.
Chair Ryan Layley.
Here.
Commissioner Martin.
Here.
Commissioner Spaulding. Commissioner Dickey.
Here.
Commissioner Pulverenti.
Here.
Commissioner Ding.
Here.
Commissioner Vella.
Here.
And Commissioner Mullen.
Here.
Commissioner Fogg. Oh, well, County Ex Officio Commissioner Fogg is not here. I guess he's excused. Because his colleague and cohort, Commissioner Carr, is here. Commissioner Cook.
Here.
Commissioner Harvey. And Ex Officio Commissioner Bramford.
Here.
Yay. We be here.
Excellent, thank you. So moving on to agenda item number two, approval of minutes of the meeting of May 22nd, 2019. It's been a while. Do I have a motion to approve said minutes?
I move approval.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
I second.
Okay, we have multiple seconds. We'll go with Ms. Pulverente as a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Any opposed? Seeing none, those minutes have been approved. So before we move on to item number three, we have a very packed agenda tonight, as everyone sees. So just to give the public some heads up of how this works, so we will have the presenters come up, present their projects, and the commissioners will then ask questions, and then we open it up to public comment. And public comment will be about 2 to 3 minutes per person. And then the commissioners will once again ask questions, and then we will make a motion on said project. So that's how the meeting will run. If someone is saying something that you're excited about, please do not speak out. Just wave your hands like jazz hands. That would be excellent. Just so there's no interruption in what's happening in the meeting. It just helps everyone stay focused. So now on to item number three. This is public comment. This is limited to items not appearing on tonight's agenda. And since it's not appearing on tonight's agenda, this commission cannot discuss it. So if you have any items to discuss that's not on tonight's agenda, please step up and let us know who you are and take it away. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Fred Allabach, 19550 8th Street East, and not on the agenda for January 21st is cannabis. I thought that's why I came down here, but this is all signs. Am I at the wrong meeting, or did you change the agenda?
This is all cannabis, yes.
Yes, hi. Good evening, Chair Layley, commissioners, members of the staff and the public. Hi, my name is Terry Shore. I am the regional director for the North Bay for Greenbelt Alliance, and I live at 515 Hopkins Street in Sonoma. I would like to bring two items to your attention that are not on the agenda. One, the renewal of the City of Sonoma's urban growth boundary, which expires at the end of 2020. And the public process that is beginning to get underway regarding the specific plan for the Sonoma Developmental Center, and my concern about the public advisory team meetings not being open to the public. So I will keep my comments short, respecting your very busy and important agenda. The voter-approved urban growth boundary in the City of Sonoma is expiring in December 2020, after 20 years. Next Monday, January the 27th, at 6 o'clock at Vintage House, the City Council of Sonoma and the Planning Commission will be holding a joint meeting to discuss steps moving forward to renew the UGB with a vote of the people before it expires. The members of the SVCAC may want to go, since you do have purview between the city and the county, to learn more. Ultimately, we would like to see you agendize the Sonoma UGB on your agenda so that you can discuss it and so that members of the public can provide you with the reasons why it's extremely important to renew it now with a vote for 20 years. The second item is that another area that's under your purview and will be coming to you at some point is the specific plan for the Sonoma Developmental Center, which will be a very, very important outcome for our community. And I'm very concerned because there is a public advisory team that is starting to meet this week with a number of different people who have been appointed to it. But those meetings are not going to be noticed, and there's going to be no agenda and no minutes. So from the perspective of Greenbelt Alliance, that seems to completely undermine the commitment to a robust public process. I understand there will be a number of other public processes underway, large public meetings where you get 1 or 2 minutes to speak. There will be some workshops, so it's not the only avenue for the public. But because documents and will be made at those meetings, I would urge the SVCAC to request that those meetings at least be open to the public for observation, even if there's no opportunity to make a lot of public comment, so we can just see what the discussion is among those members, what changes and recommendations they're making before they move on into the bigger public process. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment? Okay, seeing none, closing public comment. So now we will move into agenda item number 4, file number UPC 19-006, applicant name Sonoma's Finest 2.0 LLC, care of David Scott. Owner name Deborah Ann McKeese and Deborah DeLorenzi Family Trust. The site address is 8910 Highway 12, Unit B in Kenwood, APN 050-162-031. Project description: request for a conditional use permit for a cannabis dispensary within an existing commercial retail space, and consideration of request for setback relief. The project proposal states that there will be approximately 3 employees present at any given time. The project would operate within the hours between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m., Monday to Saturday, including deliveries. The space is a total of 1,900 square feet of vacant area. 1,250 square feet will be dedicated to retail space, with the remainder square feet allocated for storage space, office and meeting rooms and bathrooms. There will be no cannabis smoked, ingested, or otherwise consumed on site. So if the applicant could please introduce themselves, and then the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. My name is David Scott. Thank you for allowing us to present. I'm a principal partner in Sonoma's Finest, a Sonoma County native, went to elementary school through high school in Petaluma. And brief agenda. We have a slideshow if you care to check out the screens around. A little bit about who we are, what we want to do, a little bit of background on the cannabis industry, what we are asking for from the county, the benefits of having a dispensary in your community, the efforts we have made to reach out to the community, and some answers to some frequently asked questions that we get frequently, as well as information on how to stay informed and continue to be a part of this process with us. So who are we? Sonoma's Finest is comprised of 4 principal partners from numerous different backgrounds, retail, hospitality, and cannabis mainly. It's been my vision for a while now to open a dispensary in unincorporated Sonoma County, and I assembled a team around me to help fill some of the holes that I don't have experience with and provide some funding. It's quite expensive. So our proposal, as you heard, is to open a small boutique upscale cannabis dispensary in the Kenwood Village. using approximately 1,250 square feet of retail space. The vision is to be offer THC and CBD cannabis products as well as one-on-one wellness consultations for our customers to help get them the right medicine. We vision being community hub for compassionate and safe access to patients. While cannabis has moved into the recreational sector, there are still quite a few people treating ailments with cannabis. And we have now included cannabis delivery into our application as a direct result of what we heard from the community. As far as issues with traffic and parking, we are thinking that by being able to deliver to the community, it would alleviate some of the traffic in the Kenwood Village, which help appease the concerns of the neighborhood. And yeah, having a safe, simple, and secure operation with flexible options for our customers on how to get their products. So a little bit on the background, you know, recreational cannabis was passed in November of 2016. Sonoma County voted about a 60% majority yes on that, around 138,000 yes votes. So I think it's safe to say in principle, we're a cannabis friendly county. And excuse me, California state licensure requires that we get our local approval before we can get our state license, and that is approval of our CUP from Permit Sonoma. And we found that the average age of customers, recreational customers, is about 37 years old, which is a little older than we had anticipated. State cannabis laws require extensive testing of all cannabis products, so everything, you know, at the shop would be, of course, tested high quality and of no concern for safety to our patients and customers. So what we're asking for from the county is setback relief. We have submitted a request for two waivers. One is a setback relief from the residential neighborhood abutting the parking lot of the Kenwood Village. And one is for a setback relief from Shaw Park. In both cases, there are precedents in Sonoma County that of the county issuing waivers to similar projects with similar issues. In addition, we have received numerous letters of support from residents in the Kenwood neighborhood that are in between these uses in our location, voicing their explicit agreement that there are actual physical barriers that exist between our location and the sensitive uses. You see from the pictures up on the screen now, the picture on the left of each screen is showing the actual physical barrier between Shaw Park and our dispensary location. It's a Frontier Communications building with razor wire fences. In addition to this, there's numerous houses. You cannot see the dispensary location from Shaw Park. You can't even see the parking lot of the Kenwood Village from Shaw Park. The picture on the right is showcasing the actual physical barrier that exists between the parking lot and the residential neighborhood. It's a 6-foot solid wood fence all the way down with well-established bushes and trees extending much higher than 6 feet. Now, what are the benefits of having a dispensary in your community? It's actually quite a few. Of course, the biggest one is increased safe access to medicine for those that are actually still utilizing cannabis mainly for medical reasons. And we sincerely are a philanthropic team. And we see, you know, us supporting our community through nonprofits and becoming more of an incorporated, supportive member of the community. We create local economical benefits, of course. I'm sure you've heard the tax burden on cannabis businesses is quite extraordinary. So there'd, of course, be a financial benefit to the community. And our hiring bias is, of course, local preference to local residents. The last four kind of go together a little bit, you know, minimizes illicit cannabis sales, having a dispensary, less people selling cannabis on the street. And retail access has been associated with decreased opioid usage, decrease in teenage cannabis usage, and decreased crime rates. And there are studies to support these facts. So I'm going to pass off the rest of the presentation to my colleague, Herman Hernandez, who's been helping me kind of guiding me with the community outreach portion. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Good evening, everyone. How are you doing? Thank you so much for having us and allowing us this opportunity to do a quick presentation. I, like Mr. Scott, was born and raised here in Sonoma County, and I'm a huge fan of the citizens advisory committees, but more importantly, I'm from Guerneville, so the municipal advisory committees. I think it's so important that we bring a voice to the unincorporated areas of Sonoma County. I am once again going to say my name and tell you where I come from. I'm actually with the 421 group. I do public affairs strategy for them. And my name's Herman G. Hernandez. So like Mr. Scott already mentioned, we did do some community outreach, but we didn't just engage the community. We engaged them and we also listened to the neighbors and folks in the Kenwood area. We did extensive canvassing through the neighborhoods on several occasions since last summer, before August. We hosted a community open house on August 19th, where we had an amazing turnout, and we had a great dialogue and conversation with the neighbors to field their questions, their concerns, their ideas. And this was not just an effort to check the box off. This was actually because our clients genuinely care about what the opinion is and what the neighbors are looking for in a cannabis business. And I mean, there's even facts to show that they amended their application because there were some concerns about traffic and not enough parking space. And they added the delivery service because that's something that the community wanted. They are genuinely wanting to be part of the community. And let me get one of the things that we got from canvassing. We actually knocked on about 239 homes, and we were able to talk to a lot of the neighbors there. And we actually, as some of you might have in your packets, we got 57 signatures to support our petition from the local neighbors, and you can see their names and their signatures and their addresses and emails. And it's also important to note that the petition was in support of the proposed project and the setback waivers and the permit for the dispensary. We also, on the slide you're going to see, or in your packets, you'll see that we received 14 letters of support, not just from the residents, but also from the local business owners in the Kenwood area. And as I was driving here, we actually received two more via email, just to show you that there is support in the community. We also collected the business letter from Seamus Wines, Ty Caton Vineyards, Span Vineyards, and Palooza Brewery and Gastro Pub. And I just want to leave you with this before I pass it back to Mr. Scott. Our clients genuinely care about the neighborhood, and the folks in Kenwood provided an overwhelming showing of support. And this cannot go unnoticed. Once again, I just want to say thank you very much for your time this evening, and I'm more than happy to answer any questions about canvassing that we did over the last few months or 6 months.
Thank you, Herman. So just to wrap up, some pictures of letters and frequently asked questions we get a lot. Will security be on site? Of course, it's required, all state-of-the-art video. We've heard from the community that, you know, having a security guard walking around all the time might change the aesthetic of the Kenwood Village. So we've had internal talks about using plainclothes security and just adjusting to whatever fits the space of the community a little better. And of course, everyone who comes in has to be an adult. ID is required as soon as you walk in the door. It's not a cash-only business. There are now credit options for purchasing at dispensaries, so there's not going to be an exorbitant amount of money. No more cash than a normal business. No on-site consumption of any kind in any public space in California, so that includes our shop, the courtyard, the parking lot, and people's cars. There's just no consumption anywhere near the premises. And the interior of the dispensary will either be completely non-visible to the passerby, or just look like a day spa or a wine tasting room, or just see the lobby, if anything. And that of course is open to suggestion from the local community of if they want it completely invisible, or if it's okay to have a nice but discreet decor that kind of is more open but still very discreet. So thanks again. I'm David Scott. I appreciate the opportunity to present. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer those as best I can.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. I would recommend staying there because I know my fellow commissioners will have a number of questions for you. So I turn it to my fellow commissioners and we will start asking questions of Mr. Scott. Yes, Vice Chair Freeman.
First of all, thank you for your presentation.
Sure.
Thorough. And thank you also for checking with your neighbors. I think that's probably one of the most important things that we believe happens when people come before us. Just a few questions, and some of them may be relevant, some of them won't, so
sure.
Bear with me.
No problem.
So you had mentioned about razor wire on the Shaw Park. Is it between Shaw Park and the Kenwood?
The Kenwood Village, yeah.
Okay. And that existed prior to any of this discussion?
That's part of the Frontier Communications building parking lot, I believe.
Got it.
And nothing to do with our project. It just
got it. Just wanted to point that out, I guess, on some level. And then let's just say somebody does light up in the parking lot. Who's going to be responsible for kind of, are you guys going to have some responsibility for that, or is that just a general, it's the law and therefore it falls under?
My understanding is that falls under on us. So that's our security guard and our awareness of our surroundings.
Sure.
And that's in our interest of keeping our permit. You know, we can't have our patrons buying and then using in the parking lot. I'm pretty sure we'd get shut
great
down.
I just wanted to know who would be responsible for that. And so with that, you mentioned the permit. How often is the renewal process for you guys?
As of October of last year, I believe, it's now 5 years.
Every five years
up for review.
And again, I feel like this is almost inappropriate, so if you don't want to answer it, that's fine. But are you guys going to be paying minimum wage, or are your workers at a level that is higher than minimum wage?
Yeah, so philosophically, I've never paid anyone less than a living wage.
Okay.
And in Sonoma County, that's definitely not minimum wage.
Yeah.
So I will, you know.
I think that's an important point to know.
Yeah, absolutely.
So thank you.
No.
If you said there was one item that the neighbors, I think you've already addressed this, but that you said the neighbors gave feedback that was not necessarily positive, if there was one item, what would you say that was, and have you corrected it, haven't you? Is it something that is not correctable?
Yeah, so from my perspective, the issue that was brought up the most was the concern about traffic and parking in the Kenwood Village Shopping Center.
Mm-hmm.
And related to that, effects on the fire department. I spoke with the fire chief, and they're aware of the project and what we would like to do. And he has no opinion. He doesn't have no opinion. He's neutral. He doesn't feel like there's an impact on fire. And that was part of our interest in adding delivery, was to hopefully we could be delivering to residences rather than having them drive over and use the parking lot. Another concern was, a lot of the Kenwood residents utilize that post office,
mm-hmm.
so creating designated post office parking spaces, just to make sure that as residents are trying to do that, our business isn't making it harder for them. So the answer to your question, it's debatable if we've resolved it. We've definitely made efforts to resolve it and definitely made efforts to listen to the concerns and how can we work with them and make sure that their lives are not affected in a way they perceive as negative and we can still open our business.
Great. Just as an observation, I'm aware of somebody down, I live in Temelec, and I'm aware of somebody who has had deliveries from the Santa Rosa area, and I know that has posed a challenge in terms of people getting there on a timely basis for the person. So I just point that out as it might be something to note that being closer in might be more helpful to the community. So thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Spaulding.
Thank you. Yeah, good description. I think I'd love it if you could explain a little more about the parking. It indeed is challenging even now to know exactly how to, there's only one place to pull in, but then where should you go to park to go to any of the various places you may be wanting to go, post office, the newspaper, et cetera. Do you have any ability to persuade the owner of the property to improve parking direction? And would that be to your advantage as well as everyone else's?
So just to clarify, parking direction, just to increase signage or designated spaces, what are you visioning there?
All the above. When you enter, there's no adequate signage. So signage, certainly. Designated parking spaces would be very helpful. I think arrows pointing which way to drive as you come in, any of that would be useful.
Yeah, any and all of that, we're absolutely amenable to those ideas. If it improves traffic flow and helps the community at large utilize that shopping center, we have absolutely no issue with that suggestion. So far, the landowners have been extremely easy to work with and supportive of the project, so I don't foresee any issue discussing that with them.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Pulverante.
Sure.
First of all, you mentioned that you had a discussion with the fire department. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you've had any discussions with the sheriff's department about things that they've experienced that would be helpful in your planning.
No, we have not had discussions with the sheriff's department.
Okay.
We are open to doing that.
Okay.
We don't see our business as a high crime risk business based on studies that have been done and the general trend around crime and dispensaries.
Okay.
But we are absolutely open to doing that if it's something the community would like, and yeah, we can report back and our findings there.
Yeah, and I think that now that we're seeing more dispensaries opening up in the county, I think they might have some valuable input that may contribute to your planning or change it.
Of course.
And that would be the same thing with, have you interacted at all with the other dispensaries in Cotati and Sebastopol, just to get some sense of any issues they might be having that you could avoid?
Sure. As of now, we have not. And the biggest focus has been on deterrence. So the robust security systems and cameras and security staff, and it's mainly about preventing the crime rather than reacting to potential crime. But we are also open to discussing. Our team has dispensary experience. So most of those discussions have happened in-house just with our team on what do you think we should do based on our experience. So we do have that, just haven't reached out to Brandon and Cotati or any of the other local ones.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Commissioner Martin?
Yes. What criticisms, I don't know if others have received, I have from citizens and residents in the region there, is the question of how one makes a left turn in particular, but makes a turn either way when you come out of the driveway. Because people, although it's a 45-mile-an-hour limit, people go in exceed of that often. And there's just, it seems to me that that's a serious problem. Because I go there, I visit the place. I've looked at your facility that you're going to go into. Your neighbor next door is not pleased with you being there. One of the wine tasting places, I understand others are in support of you. But what do you say about that left and right turn outside the premises onto Highway 12 in terms of danger?
A couple things. We have heard that concern from some of the residents, and internal discussions have been, you know, it's not any different than any other customer or patron of any of the other businesses that have to turn out in or out of that parking lot. What I personally have done is, if it's busy going towards Santa Rosa but not busy going towards Sonoma, I take my left and I stop in the little space right there, and then once it's clear, I merge into the lane going back to Santa Rosa and go home. We don't foresee this as a, like, the Walmart of dispensaries. You know, this is like a small upscale boutique dispensary that we're envisioning here. And our anticipation of 100 patrons per day, we don't equate to 100 vehicles per day. We feel like there's going to be quite a bit of overlap of people utilizing other services in that shopping center and just adding us to their list of stops. So we don't see it in quite the same light as some of the citizens of, if this dispensary comes in, it's all going to be impossible to get out of this parking lot. We just see it slightly differently. It is dangerous, but it's not like we're not doing anything new. You know, it's dangerous now. It's not like we're making it dangerous. And it doesn't seem dangerous to me. Every time I try to get out of there, I get out of there safely. You just wait, put your blinker on and merge carefully. And it's been my personal experience getting out of there.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Ding.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I have a question here. The last sentence is no consumption on site. How do you carry it out, or any measurement?
So what does our plan do to ensure that is enforced? Is that the question?
Yes.
Yeah, so that would be on our security staff doing, you know, routine checks of the parking lot and surrounding area from our shop. And our cameras would alert us to that as well. We'll have security cameras keeping tabs on the building and surrounding area. So it falls on us and our security staff to notice, pay attention.
Another question is, what is your entrance and the main entrance? In the courtyard or in the north side?
So we've had a lot of discussions about that based on feedback from the community. We're open to using either or. The one that we've been talking about most recently is utilizing a discrete entrance on the courtyard side and then the exit from the back of the building. So after you buy your cannabis products, you end up in the north parking lot. And that's mostly to, you know, not wave it around in front of children or families that may be in the courtyard eating. You go out on the other side and then walk around to your car. But that's not set in stone. That's just one idea we had to kind of appease all sides.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions from Commissioner? Yes, please go ahead, Mr. Reed.
Yes.
Sorry. Commissioner Keyser first. Thank you. Sorry.
You said that you're asking for setback relief. What's the current setback?
As it's written?
Where's the current houses located? How far back?
We just know they're within 100 feet from the property line of the parking lot. So the backyard of the house butts up against the parking lot, and that's less than 100 feet from the residences.
But you're not sure the distance?
From the actual house to our building? Or
you're not sure how much you're short? What setback?
Well, the property lines, they touch, I believe. The parking lot and then the house property line, they abut one another.
And then you said you're going to have about 100 patrons?
That's what we're estimating, yeah.
And what's your proposed service area? What are you expecting? Where are you expecting these customers to come from?
Primarily from the Sonoma Valley.
Okay. Not Santa Rosa?
Our hope is that, you know, Santa Rosa has about 30 dispensaries slated to open in the next year. So we're pretty sure that the Santa Rosa market's going to be taken by those dispensaries. And our goal is really to service the Sonoma Valley market that currently doesn't have that option.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Dickey?
Yeah, I have kind of an odd question. You said, Mr. Hernandez said that you interviewed, polled roughly 200 neighbors. And you have here 60 of them that signed a petition in support of your proposal. And I'm wondering if during the discussions that you inevitably have when you go door to door, if there is, I'm wondering if there's a stigma about marijuana that as a commercial operation as opposed to personal use, and the resistance that you may hear tonight to your proposal. And I'm sort of curious as to whether the community is resistant to it as a commercial operation as opposed to its, you know, its application either recreational or medicine. And it would be somewhat reflective in these poll numbers and the petition numbers in that you would, you know, go through and interview, you know, poll 200 people and 57 of them say, yeah, sure, we're in supportive. And a good portion of the rest of those probably voted in support of marijuana for the county, but didn't realize that the unintended consequence of that might be that they may have a dispensary in their own neighborhood. And I'm wondering if, Mr. Hernandez, when you went through those neighborhoods, if that was at any point part of the discussion that took place.
Sure. All right, Mr. Dickey, Commissioner Dickey. So actually, just to clarify one thing, we walked 239 homes. Not everybody opened their door because they weren't home, and some of the homes are actually rentals, or they're just not, they were not home any of the times that we walked them. We actually spoke to 91 homes, and 57 of them signed the petition. And to go back to the second part of your question, I'm actually on the Sonoma County Board of Education. I've been serving on there for 6 years, and when this was legalized, cannabis was legalized, it was a very tough conversation to be having with the parents that were going to our schools and having these discussions with the neighbors who were upset about it being within 1,000 feet, especially in the city of Santa Rosa. So we had all types of different conversations when it came to this specific dispensary. And I don't know if that actually answers the second part of your question, but can you clarify a little more the second part of your question?
Yeah, mostly I'm kind of curious about the conflict that exists. You know, this is not the first proposal that we've heard, you know, and I would guess that the majority of the people in this room are probably in support of marijuana one way or another. Medicine, recreation, as a libertarian value, however you want to phrase it and look at it. But when it comes to dispensing it in a neighborhood or in a community or in a storefront, the conflicts become somewhat narrower. You know, it's like, oh, okay, but I didn't think that it was going to happen here. So I'm trying to discern for myself if that's how maybe the people that you discuss this with, of the 90, if there was a percentage of them that said that, you know, that said, wow, you know, I didn't expect that there would be a dispensary in Kenwood when I voted for this law that was going to legalize marijuana. And so I think that's sort of what I'm trying to judge for myself, you know. And maybe it's an intellectual curiosity, maybe it's because it's the rule of unintended consequences, but it does have value in terms of this overall discussion for our communities, you know, that they have impacts, and, you know, so that's the nature of my question.
Right, and I mean, I also do a lot of work in the Latino community, being born and raised here in Sonoma County, but my mother being from Mexico, and cannabis has been heavily stigmatized as a very, very negative drug. People who have been murdered. I mean, we live in a country where it's still not legal in all the states. So yes, these concerns are valid concerns and something that exists in the illegal distribution of cannabis. But for me, I work for 421 Group because I wanted to learn more about the cannabis industry, especially having to deal with the dispensaries, manufacturing, cultivators around schools. That's how I got involved in this. And I was shocked to learn all the regulatory things that they have to go through, all the security stuff that they have to do that other normal businesses don't have to do. And also to learn more about how they've been in the shadows, and it's been now legalized for 4 years. So this is definitely something that as a community, and I know I'm getting philosophical here, but as a community, we actually have to have more discussion and education about what legal cannabis is.
Could I interrupt you for a moment?
Absolutely.
And just, you polled 97 people and spoke with 91. Them directly. Okay, 91 people. Of those people, did
anybody...
Are you
asking for the people who said they don't
yeah.
want...
Yeah, I'm
oh,
kind
we
of
had
curious
nine,
as to...
Nine homes.
I'm
sorry,
just
I didn't understand your question.
What I'm wondering here is when you came to them and said, hey, we're going to open a dispensary in your neighborhood, what was the reaction to the ones that did not sign? Other than the fact that they said, well, I'm not going to sign this, did they say to you, well, I'm supportive of marijuana use, but I didn't know that they were going to open a dispensary in my neighborhood?
Yeah, we
and
definitely
that's
had
sort of
those,
what I'm asking.
We definitely had those answers, and we had 9 of the 91 people say that they would not support the project. But yes, those concerns were voiced. And in the undecided community, there were some people who were talking about, sorry, there were some people who were talking about that, yes, they supported, they voted for it, but they don't really care if it's here or not, and they don't have an opinion, a strong opinion, whether it's for or against. So,
just to piggyback off of that, the main thing that I found to answer this question is that even the people that said they didn't want it said they don't care about cannabis. They don't want any successful business in Kenwood, in a commercially zoned building, whether it's cannabis or not cannabis. So it's just like, you know, it's that's a hard one. So how do you have a commercially zoned space and then tell the group that wants to go in there to open a business, cannabis or not, that we're not supportive of any successful business here because it's going to generate traffic? Well, any successful business is going to generate traffic. We're just selling, we're a burgeoning industry. That's the only difference, is we're selling cannabis products. So yes, there were people that voiced that concern. When I've told my friends and colleagues what I've been doing, I say no one cares about cannabis. It's a successful business. That's the overwhelming majority of the people that are opposed to it, is it's the business aspect. It's not anything to do with the cannabis or risks of cannabis. That's sincerely what I've been finding. Does that answer your question?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Commissioner Carr?
I've sat in probably five or six dispensary permits in the county, and maybe about seven or eight outdoor grow permits in the county. And the number of people who opposed the legislation and who are against, philosophically against, the legalization of marijuana are strong advocates of denying permits for cultivation outdoors particularly, and to a lesser degree, the dispensaries. And mostly I think that's because the dispensaries tend to be in commercial industrial zones. They're mixed with other commercial industrial uses where you have less likely to have close-in neighborhood issues. But there's no question that all of those permits, whether dispensaries or outdoor grows or indoor grows in the rural area, raise neighborhood issues. And I suspect in this case, especially given Mr. Scott's mentioning the fact that no one wants a successful business in Kenwood, well, those people probably been going to VJB hearings for the last 10 years, you know, and it is unfortunate that there are the more successful commercial businesses in this particular location raise big issues, whether they're winery event, winery tasting rooms, eventually cannabis perhaps, and other uses in this area. So I completely understand, you know, those nine people or whatever that are worried about any business that's going to be successful. So, you know, good luck trying, right? But I do think that it's important to separate, with all due respect to VJB, it's important to separate a business that is over capacity and ones that are, you know, operating at a reasonable level in that are consistent with what most commercial zones in rural areas like Kenwood are doing. So if this business becomes successful, that's going to be a problem, and that's why those people are saying that. And if this business is, you know, okay, or, you know, middle of the road, maybe successful but not overwhelming, you know, it's probably going to be fine, and it's going to probably just be like the tasting room that in the building that he's replacing. So hopefully that answers both your questions. It is definitely a philosophical issue in many cases, and a neighborhood issue in many. It's really hard to separate that out a lot of times.
Thank you.
Can I
oh, absolutely, speak please. To
that? And I heard that quite a bit from people. You know, oh, VJB. You know, VJB came in. They said all this. They're going to put in a parking lot and. We can't have that happening again. It's like, you know, basically they ruined it for everyone after them is what I was hearing from these residents. And by no means do we consider ourselves a VJB. I don't know what that is. It's a winery, I'm assuming, or wine tasting or something like that. But we've been listening to the community. We've amended our application to help appease some of the concerns, and we will do what we say we're going to do. And I'm not going to put in a giant parking lot. Not even going to try to promise that because we can't do that. So, yeah, you're totally right. And it's unfortunate that these businesses do come in and jade the communities, because everyone that comes after now has to deal with that resentment that comes from businesses coming in.
Thank you. Any other questions from Commissioner? Yes, Commissioner Pulvarenti.
I just want to make one comment, and David, correct me if I'm wrong, okay? Right now, you're talking about the dispensary up in Kenwood. So your clientele will potentially be coming from our area, driving up to Kenwood. So when you first open, you may have a lot of people that once the dispensary's opened in Sonoma, that'll pull away from that, because our city council has approved a dispensary in Sonoma. So you're going to have one in Sonoma eventually, after it gets through all the permitting. You're going to have one in Kenwood. So it's going to disperse the people, is what I'm trying to say. So anyway.
And I'm guessing that would alleviate traffic concerns at the Kenwood, Kenwood Village. Yes. And our emphasis is going to be, you know, as much delivery as we can, based on what we've been hearing from some of the residents.
Okay, I have a few questions. Why this location?
Originally, because it's actually extremely hard to find suitable locations in unincorporated Sonoma County. There was a long period of time that we're still in, actually, where of the 9 potential dispensaries that are approved for unincorporated Sonoma County, only 4 or 5 of them are up and operational because it's so hard to find the real estate. So we found this spot and thought it was a good fit and underserviced market and went from there.
Do you plan on having regular public meetings like you held before opening this business?
We've talked about it and we are very open to it. Most of the people that that care to be involved in our process, we're still in contact with, but we are totally open to holding another open house and hearing from the community where we're at now, and if there's still concerns, how we can best address those concerns.
Thank you. So this might be a daft question, but it's both medical and recreational in nature?
Okay. Yeah, when we initially submitted our applications, the County of Sonoma hadn't rewritten their ordinance to allow for recreational, and since that has happened, we've amended our application to include that.
Okay, and who is supplying the product, if you can say such, or how far are they traveling to supply said product?
So, you know, my interest based on who I am is local organic. That's how I live my life. So starting as close as we can to our location and just moving out until we've filled all the boxes we need to check for various products. Some products are hard to get locally, especially CBD products. So it may be further out. Initially, but as soon as we can get them locally, we will. And as soon as it's possible to label organic cannabis products, we'll start incorporating those into our shop.
And as far as the layout of the space, I know we've looked at applications in the past that have like an ante room before people are allowed into the shop. So there is a layer of removal. So people just can't bombard in. Obviously, that's the same idea with this place.
Yeah, that's the same idea. Earlier when I mentioned, you know, we can totally black it out and have you can't see in at all, or you can maybe see into a reception room like you would for like a day spa or something like that. So it's open and welcoming. It's not like a, you know, blacked out building, which is kind of off-putting, but you still wouldn't be able to see any product or have any idea that it's a cannabis shop until you actually go into the shop proper. And if you're a minor, you get weeded out immediately. So.
And then back to Commissioner Keezer's question as far as the setbacks, which we're looking at this evening. Do you know how far within those setbacks you are? Because it was 1,000 feet to Shaw Park and then 100 to... So how to echo her question, how short are you? You're like 950, you're 870,
right. So
something like that.
Our building is about 880 feet from Shaw Park. And as I mentioned before, the residential properties abut the parking lot. So we haven't done, as the crow flies, from our building like to an actual house, because the property lines are touching. We just went off of that.
Okay, thank you. I think that's all my questions for now. Any other questions? Yes, Commissioner Carr.
I think the setback requirement is from the building to the nearest property line. And if that's the case, I think you're probably 50 or 60 feet, just based on driving.
There's just that little alleyway.
Yeah, there's a little grass area, and then but that could be a little bit off. I was wondering if you've actually looked into your right of access going to the north. Does the property owner own that strip of dirt road that goes back to the north?
Are you talking about the one that goes by the dentist office?
Yeah. Straight north, and then so you can get on that side street. And I apologize, I'm forgetting the name of the side street. And then go left or right on 12.
I don't feel educated enough to answer that question at the moment, but I'd be happy to look into it.
I think it'd be worth looking into. You might sometimes dividing out the trips.
Absolutely. And we've talked about, based on concerns, telling our patrons, hey, here's the easiest way to get out of here. You know, if you want to get out of here, go, you know, to the street, Randolph, I believe it is, and go out that stop sign. If you're going left or if you're going right, just use the main entrance.
But you'd need right of access, and you'd need encroachment.
Absolutely.
You
don't
have to
Absolutely.
Be a regulated strip there.
Yeah, we can definitely look into that.
Okay, yeah, I think that'd be a good idea.
Yes, please, Commissioner Crowley.
Could you please tell us your proposed hours of operation? And a number of the letters that I saw that were against your project cited parking issues specifically with regard to the post office.
Sure.
So I want to know about overlapping hours,
sure,
post office, and what you see as your peak hours.
Yeah, it's a good question. So right now we put in our application operating between the hours of 7 and 7. I don't think we're going to be utilizing that whole window. It doesn't make sense. Peak hours for a dispensary typically are later in the day, after work, like 4 to 9 or however late you can be open. We were happy to hear that because that kind of gets away from the post office hours of operation. What was your first question? I'm sorry. You had a...
You got it.
Oh, I got it. Okay. Okay, cool.
Okay. Any other questions from commissioners?
One more thing I did want to say is I was made aware that the Postal Service does actually offer residential delivery of mail now to the Kenwood neighborhood back there, and all you need is a mailbox. So as time goes on, the traffic going to the post office for at least checking your P.O. box may decrease in theory.
Actually, that brings up one more question. Your delivery service, would that be at set hours? So like the van leaves at 11 a.m. and 3 p.m.? Or, since we're talking about traffic, how do you see this being mitigated?
Yeah, so that's really going to depend on the routes and where we're getting calls from. I would imagine so, because it doesn't make sense financially from a business perspective to be driving there and back and there and back and there and back. So it'd be, you know, you got to get on our route you got to chime in for your house by 11 a.m. to get on the route one, or you're going to be on route two. And we can definitely work with the community to find times of doing that are not in conjunction with the busiest times in the parking lot. So yeah, probably something like 10 a.m. After people go to work, before lunch, and then again after lunch.
Thank you. Any other questions from commissioners? Okay. You may be seated.
Thank you.
And I'm going to open this up. Thank you for your presentation and answering questions. So I am going to open this up to public comment. And please tell us who you are. And we will give you 3 minutes. And I will raise my hand when you're getting close. And then I will promptly let you know when the 3 minutes is up. Go right ahead.
Thank you. I'm Fred Alabach, 19550 8th Street East, and I don't really have a strong stake in this particular issue, but I did have a few comments, and since I came down and have to smell the outgassing of the fresh varnish, I might as well at least make a comment. One thing that occurred to me is that I wonder if any other legal businesses in the county of any sort come before the SVCAC as a matter of course, or is it just because it's cannabis? And if it is a legal business and it is legal, I'm curious as to why there's such involved questioning of the business. It doesn't seem right if it is legal.
And I also like to second Commissioner Pulverandi's observation that the more dispensaries there are, the less business there's going to be for each one. So the more of them that get open, then eventually all of them are going to get less business, and there'll probably be attrition with them. Let's see. And then every time I look at any sort of booklet in Sonoma County of Sonoma County tourism, everybody's got a wine glass in their hand. Everybody's got wine, like even wine in dog bowls, maybe. And so, but drinking and driving is a serious problem. And alcoholism is a serious problem. And just because you have a white tablecloth on it and fancy glasses, if that was Boone's Farm and, you know, Pabst Blue Ribbon or whatever, then people will go, we can't have that. But, you know, so it just seems like a tremendous double standard to be so kind of, you know, have the antenna up for cannabis. But then it's just great, and everyone has a wine glass in their hand. So something is wrong with that picture to me, as far as you know, being on the cannabis. And let's see, what else do I have? And then this seems to fit the same pattern as everything else, that everyone's for it, but they just don't want it anywhere near them. So that's for everything, for homeless, for affordable housing, for cannabis, for wine tasting, for anything. And so that seems to, could be maybe, you know, the motto of Sonoma County. Everyone's for it, but just don't put it anywhere near me.
Thank you. Please step up to the podium if you have public comment. And let us know who you are.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Susan Lyon. I live in Kenwood. And unfortunately, I did not make the neighborhood meeting in August, so I missed that opportunity to listen. So I may have missed some of my questions about this, but...
Can you bring the microphone closer to your mouth?
Can you hear me? Is that better?
Oh.
Yeah, anyway, so I may have missed a lot of the questions and answers in the neighborhood meeting in August, but I am somewhat directly affected by this particular use in the neighborhood because I live directly behind it. And so I have questions about, concerns about the setback, the 100-foot setback. I walked it off before I came here, and my fence, which is directly behind this, is 70 feet. And I have no concerns about cannabis in our neighborhood or in the shopping center as a use. Really, I feel like it's no different than a winery, tasting room, a restaurant, anything like that. But my concerns have to do with the setback and something that nobody's brought up that I will mention, or maybe it was mentioned in the August meeting, but there's a tremendous amount of noise. Some of the problems with having the commercial use right by the homes in that neighborhood is that there's a lot of noise. I've been there for 2 years now, short time. I realize I love the community, the neighborhood, and all the businesses behind us. But it begins at about 5:45 when the post office rolls up, the truck rolls up, and the doors open. It's quite loud, very difficult to sleep through that. And then the advent of all the Amazon trucks, which is great. I shop online. I like those boxes too. But there's a lot of traffic back there, and it's quite noisy. Earplugs help, so does CBD oil to try to sleep. And I drive to Sebastopol for those products, not the earplugs, but the other. And there is a, I think Soulful is a good business model. I really like the way they do things, and I think that if Mr. Scott and Hernandez does things the way that business does, they'll be doing great. But the setback is a concern for me because of the noise, and I don't think there's not much they can do about that. My fence doesn't look exactly like the picture in the slideshow. Maybe I need to plant some trees in Vast. But my other concern has to do with the security. So there, I'm sure there'll be guards like there is in the Sebastopol model that are there during business hours, but at night, I think if we end up being reactive to break-ins, attempted break-ins, robberies, even if they're silent alarms, the sheriff having to patrol the area and all the noise and whatnot that comes with that will be alarming for some of us. So I realize I've been a commercial property manager for 40 years, and I know that the expense to have a standing guard round the clock would be prohibitive.
Time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So those are my concerns. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Chris Cook. My wife, Lynn, and I live in Kenwood. And I don't think this issue tonight before you is really about cannabis use. I think it's about the appropriateness of the site. Kenwood, as you know, is a little tiny village. It's got 1,000 people. It's not going to support this dispensary. I was at the August town hall meeting that David talked about. And at that town hall meeting, the way they described their marketing plan is they wanted to be the dispensary between Napa and Santa Rosa. Now that Sonoma has agreed to have one, there'll be two dispensaries between Napa and Santa Rosa. There's a lot of people. They're picking this site right because it's on Highway 12 and you got thousands of cars going by all the time. This is going to be a congested, popular facility. They're planning on marketing to South Valley, Middle Valley, Oakmont. They're trying to cover the whole valley with this. This is going to be very, very busy. The left-hand turn lane out of this facility is not a good turn lane. I don't think it's even up to standards for going towards Oakmont. It is certainly not according to design standards. And when people try to make that turn, it's dangerous, particularly at rush hour. As David himself said, he used the word dangerous. There's different ways you might get around all that, but they're not easy. The traffic backs up. When people are trying to make that hard left-hand turn, it's a safety problem, and it's going to be much worse. Make no mistake, this is not just going to replace the former Orpheus tasting room. Orpheus Winery was a small little tasting room, had a few people a day come to it. He's saying 100 people a day. I think that's lowballing if his marketing plan is what he represented at the August town hall meeting. This is going to be a very popular place. It's going to create safety concerns for the community. We have to go to the post office, we do every day, to get our mail for a lot of reasons. It's right adjacent to the post office entry. This is going to be a congested area. We shouldn't have to hunt and peck for parking places. And I'm concerned about the safety concerns for the traffic going in and out of this place. There are nine, the county's designated, there can be nine dispensaries in unincorporated Sonoma County. I have to believe there are going to be safer places, better places to put this than right on Highway 12 with an adequate left-hand turn lane coming out and all the congestion it's going to create. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chad I'm Chad Wyatt. I'm a resident of Kenwood. I live on Misboro Way, right behind this proposed facility. I'm an attorney here in Sonoma County, and I have two little girls who would visit the post office every day and go buy a cannabis dispensary. Two little girls who are going to go to the school and return from the school, both to and from. A dispensary will be open at that time. Some of the other parents asked me to show up on their behalf. I haven't spoken to one parent who's in favor of this, and that's to put it very politely. I think there's a little bit of a credibility gap. The town hall meeting, I was glad that they put it on. But by the end of it, the comments were so critical, I started to feel a little bad for the guys who had put it on. The wall that supposedly is going to be what saves this as an exclusion is just one block. It goes around a utility area. I walk past it to get my mail. I just walk right around it. So the idea that there's this razor wire wall that's going to keep it from Kenwood is totally false. The entrance is connected to a path right there. I agree with the comments that it's a school town. It's anchored by the school. The people in the community volunteer in the school. The idea that this ordinance was passed with Kenwood in mind, I think, surrenders to plausibility. This is exactly the type of place where it was not supposed to go, which is why we have these setback provisions. To get to Shaw Park, it's not hard. You go outside the parking lot and take a right. It's right there. To get to the community, you stand on your tiptoes to look over someone's fence, or you go to the trail behind it. The setbacks are not, the barrier that has been described is not there. As far as the kids going past it, some of the parents are concerned about crime. It is still definitely federally illegal. It's hard to get banking. So folks are going to have to deal in cash. People are concerned about unscrupulous folks who might want to access that cash and how they're going to get it if the dispensary does not want to give it up. My concern is more normalization of cannabis products on developing mines, which scientifically for sure is not good for them, versus folks in Oakmont whose minds are developed enough they can make their own choices. We can't all get mail delivered to our houses in Kenwood. We have to go to the post office. My kids skip behind me to go get it. If this goes in, they're going to pass that every single day. I'm against it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jim Simmons. I live in Kenwood with my wife, Susan, and we are against this. We don't think it's an appropriate use for this location. And so we went through the application from the Sonoma's Finest, and there's several things came up. There's an omission, which I'm surprised hasn't come up yet, but the Kenwood Elementary School is within 650 feet of the their schoolyard and the parking lot. Straight line. It's a straight line. So again, you're talking about why not in our community, where there is things like that aspect. Shaw Park is 450 feet. The razor wire, well, yeah, if I can walk into a razor wire, I can walk into a telephone pole, but when I walk to the street, to the park, it's 450 feet away. The applicant in his application stated that park was only used by non-juveniles, and I was there a week ago, and the brand new tot lot had three moms and five preschoolers there. The entire park is used by, you know, all it's a central part of Kenwood. So that the mission about the school is important. The park, as far as the access, I think that's very important. Other things that came up in the, you know, they're talking about parking in the application. They call it there's a total of 15 parking spots, two for the employees. But if you read further, well, we're going to have three employees. We're going to have a supervisor. We're going to have delivery service, and we're going to have security. That leaves eight parking spots plus a van accessible for their conservative estimate of 100 people. That their peak period is between 4 and 7. That parking lot has two entrances, one on 12 that we talked about, the access. The other one goes towards Randolph right into the fire department's driveway for the emergency vehicles. So you can imagine this is passed at 3:30 on Friday when everybody's picking up their child, 4 o'clock peak period for the four tasting rooms, the Palooza, and they have their outdoor area, which is doubles their size. It's a gridlock. There's not enough parking. So I think we're not talking about a successful business. We're just talking about, you know, it's about the traffic. It's not about somebody being successful. So that if you have gridlock, then the first responders can't get their fire trucks out. So I think that's we're trying to be objective here instead of subjective. We're talking about, you know, if this was a hamburger joint, it'd be the only place to get a hamburger from Santa Rosa, West Santa Rosa, you know, to Napa. Now we're going to have two places to get it. We can get Pamper. It's going to be packed, and it's not going to work. If you go to the other ones, there's many, many wineries, but they're not. But they're, you know, it's part of the culture. So
10 seconds.
Not too long, but I think the main thing I think I would ask you is to visit the site and really see how packed it is at any given time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Kathy Pons, Valley of the Moon Alliance. We sent in our comments earlier, so I won't repeat them all, but basically, I wanted to kind of go over a couple of things that David Scott talked about. Being against the success of a business is not necessarily what the community is against. We want successful businesses, but we also want businesses that can be managed or evaluated with the number of people that really are going to frequent it. You know, if there are going to be 100 people, and that's what we're gauging, and that's what we're we're looking at as far as traffic and other concerns, then let's just, you know, evaluate that and not have any more. I mean, if it is a truly more successful business and has 200 people that come daily, then that is going to be more impact on the community and more impact on the concerns that we have been expressing. So maybe somehow, I don't know what kind of reporting they have to do on a regular basis, but, you know, like, for instance, it's always been more valuable to have data on this, and maybe, you know, data on how many people come in a day and that kind of thing will help. And then having some kind of evaluation down the road to see how it's working out or whatever. But that is that the impacts of an overly successful business, you know, is kind of like the things you can't count on or evaluate. The delivery to the community is great, but, you know, but there's also the trucks that are going to come delivering product to them. So how does that work in, and where do they offload and you know, drive around? The other thing was that I was curious, somebody mentioned having a guard there 24 hours, 24/7. Is that what's going to happen? Is that what they need to have happen, or is a burglar alarm or whatever alarm system enough to keep them, you know, safe or, you know, in the evening? Also, I was just curious. I too go get my mail at the post office, and
10 seconds, please.
And I just was curious if the cameras are going to keep track of me going back and forth too.
Oh, yeah. Smile.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Yes, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. My name is Danny Rossetti with Rossetti Consulting, public policy and community outreach specialist. I'm working with the consultant team. I just heard a couple things come up, so I was wondering if it was okay if I addressed those.
We're still in public comment, so I think not yet. I think we still have to do public comment here.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you wouldn't mind waiting for a couple minutes, if we have any other public comment. Yes, please.
Good evening. I'm Dave Jefferson. I live at 1 Mound Avenue in Kenwood and have for the past 10 years. We have a post office box there since there's no home delivery. And I freely acknowledge that any kind of viable business in our little shopping center there is going to make it more difficult in the parking lot. And there's probably an argument that sooner or later there's going to need to be an additional traffic light on 12 to address traffic at that shopping center or at the fire station. But although I don't know these gentlemen and I don't have a dog in their fight, I did assist a friend here in Sonoma, a city, a couple of years ago in gaining signatures for the initiative that presumably on the ballot this coming fall. And I pressed a lot of doorbells and talked to a lot of people. I'm no real pro and not a user of cannabis, but I'm now of the opinion that a good portion of it is a miracle drug. I'm also aware that at least in the city of Sonoma, about 65-70% of the people are strongly for cannabis. About 25% are, you know, without exception, totally opposed and will not change their opinion. And probably 10%, you know, no opinion. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if that's roughly the feelings in the community of Kenwood as well. So your observations and questions, Commissioner Dickey, are right on the money. And I'm sympathetic with the people that live across the fence in terms of noise, but I used to live near an airport, and in the community, everybody near the runways were opposed to the flights, and further away, it was not an issue. Since it is now legal in California to sell cannabis through licensed facilities, I think the issue with children is moot and a responsibility of the parents.
10 seconds.
That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing none, I'm closing public comment. Question for my county helpers and staff. Regarding the attorney, if I'm getting your title correct, is it possible for him to tell us what he was going to tell us, or does that fall under the presentation that we just heard?
No, I think you typically would leave the opportunity for the applicant to make a rebuttal to anything that he's heard, and if that's what Dennis is trying to do, I see nothing wrong with allowing that.
Thank you. That was my feeling. I just wanted to make sure. Okay. Yes, and please tell us who you are again.
Denny Rossetti, public outreach consultant, policy as well. I'm not an attorney, so...
I apologize.
not chasing any ambulances or anything like that. No practicing law without license. I'm not a insurance adjuster, any of that kind of stuff either. So, and actually, I didn't really have much of a rebuttal other than to say that, you know, David, I've been working with him the last several months on this project. I've known him for a number of years. We worked on a cannabis industry association together for a number of years, served as volunteers there. He's an early adopter of regulation in the cannabis industry, and I just think, you know, when he asked me to get involved in this project, I was very excited to hear that he had figured out a pathway where it worked for him. I had the opportunity as part of our team to look at the Sonoma Valley traffic study that was done recently by the county. Some interesting information in there, very extensive, including the look at the northern portion of the valley. And, you know, our team is very willing to look at a traffic study for the site if that's required or you know, requested by the county. We're hoping to get approved here, but we also want to be very conscious and sensitive to the local concerns, because we have heard the traffic concerns. We have added delivery to our application that wasn't initially in there as a way to consider these concerns and a way to kind of alleviate some of the concerns that might be out there. I think especially for regular customers, delivery would be a great option. I think we also have to look at greenhouse gas impacts of not having a dispensary at this site, because folks are finding ways to get their legal cannabis from other avenues. Therefore, deliveries are coming from farther away. They're also driving further. So there could be the potential that we may be reducing traffic impacts on some level through having a dispensary at the site. Thank you for your consideration of those points.
Thank you.
And wingman for Denny, Craig Litwin. I am a former Sebastopol mayor. I co-authored our dispensary ordinance years ago, back in 2005, and I'm a lifelong Sonoma County resident. Denny and I have worked on many political campaigns together. And I'm the CEO of 421 Group, who David reached out to last year to get assistance with the best ways to reach out to the community. I've been working full-time in this industry since 2000. I've worked up and down the state. I've personally negotiated numerous leases with landlords looking for dispensary locations since 2008. It's very difficult to do. Waivers have been issued. They're not unprecedented. They've been issued for the proximity of a residential lot for a different dispensary on Eli Road. So this is, you know, something that's not new. you know, we're just asking to be considered to be given a fair shake at the hearing of the BZA. My wife this morning asked, "How good luck at the trial?" I'm not an attorney. I started collecting signatures for Prop 215, so it's definitely the thing that legalized us in the beginning. So I come at it from an activist standpoint. And the thing that attracted me and my team to David, to Mr. Scott, was his sincere desire to personally engage and talk to the neighbors. I can't tell you how many people I have to convince to reach out to the neighbors. And he came to me and said, not only do I need help doing it, but I want to do it myself. I want to go out there and I want to shake hands. I want to have open houses. I want to talk to folks. That means something. These are the people we need to give permits to, the ones who are going to give back to the community, who are going to donate time and money, who are going to listen, who are going to have the community liaison. So I urge you to approve or recommend approval for this permit and to recommend granting of the two waivers. And I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Okay, now I turn it back to commissioners for comments and a motion. Yes, Commissioner Pulferenti.
I have a question just because I'm naive about this. When you have a dispensary, and now because cannabis is approved for both medical and recreational, when I enter a dispensary, I need to show ID that says I'm 21. If I live outside of California and I'm a tourist and I decide to stop at a tasting room in Kenwood and I notice that there's a dispensary, can I go in there and buy that as long as I have proof I'm 21, even from I'm from a state that doesn't? Okay, thank you.
I saw a head shaking yes. I see many heads shaking yes. To answer your question, yes. Emphatically yes from Commissioner Spaulding. Yes, Commissioner Vella.
I have a couple of comments. One is I navigate the Sonoma post office parking lot daily. To me, the Sonoma post office parking lot is a war zone. And I just can't believe that approximately four more cars an hour, which is what we're talking about here at the expected 100 cars a day, 100 customers a day at this over a 12-hour period, is going to add to this parking lot. Just wanted to put it in perspective.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Freeman.
I just wanted to point out, I think people have been talking about the fact that this would be one dispensary between Napa and Santa Rosa. We had approved in 2019 a location that is in the valley, and I just want that to be a statement of fact. In addition, we keep talking about deliveries and trucks, and I don't think in this instance we're talking about trucks, at least certainly not the outbound, and I just was wondering if somebody could confirm that. Like, a delivery to a home isn't going to be from a truck. It's going to be somebody driving an Uber car or something like that. Is that correct? Okay. Thank you. Just wanted to confirm that.
Electric cars?
Yes, Commissioner Spaulding.
I think I'd like to move us along. There will still be plenty of time for discussion after I make a motion. So I'm going to move that we recommend approval of this application and with the waivers for the setbacks, with these conditions, that the applicant make every effort to improve the parking situation through better signage and potentially space allocations, that the applicant continue to hold community meetings of some frequency in order to continue to monitor how you're working with the community. Let me interrupt my motion for a second and say, officially there will not be any monitoring of this operation for 5 years. Is that correct? It won't come up for review?
Not necessarily. Most of the The dispensaries and the grows that have had some neighborhood issues similar to this one have had earlier review. They may not necessarily get a five-year permit. Maybe the permit comes in early, or there's a five-year with a periodic review. And Kathy Pons mentioned the idea of calculating the number of people that visit. Oftentimes there are requirements for the operator, the owner to provide data like that for that review.
Okay, so amending my own motion so far to continue to hold community meetings, provide data on usage, on customer usage, and to work closely with the county, whether you get a five-year permit or less, just to make sure that that monitoring process is in place. I'd also recommend for this approval that you engage in improved access and egress, whether that means opening, getting access to another driveway or what. You need to have a little bit better control over access and egress. Thank you.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table. Do I have a second? Is that a second from Ms. Pulverenti? Okay, I'm going to do a roll call vote. You know I love to do that. Actually, I should probably slow myself down here. Are there any other comments that commissioners would like to make before we move forward with this motion?
To clarify, you mean, when you say customer count, customer data, I think was your phrase, you mean cars is what you mean, right?
Not necessarily. I think the request from a community member was for data, and I think it was broadly intended to cover cars, people, congestion.
Okay.
Is that, if I may comment on my own comments, but excuse me. The thing about this project is we don't know. Dispensaries are still very new. It'll be the first one perhaps to open here, although you're right, we've had a couple of others come before us, one of which we recommended approval. Because we don't know, I think it's prudent to approve with caution. And so let's proceed with as much data as we can get. I mean, my real comment is that, alas, friends and neighbors, the community of Kenwood is sitting on a state highway that is not going to be, the traffic is not going to go down. The usage of Kenwood is going to increase. And if we have a legal usage, such as this can be, we need to embrace it and accommodate it and also monitor it. So we don't know what's going to happen. Let's keep a close eye on it. Thanks.
I agree with Commissioner Spaulding. I think it says a lot about the applicant that they reached out so diligently to their neighbors. It's not something we necessarily see all the time here, which is excellent to see. And this industry is extremely regulated, far more so than said tasting rooms. The use permits are conditional, which is pretty amazing. So there are levels of conditions that we see, and they can be revoked. That to me is the biggest component. So I thank you for that motion, and I think it's a good project. Any other comments before we go into roll call? Okay, the motion was seconded by Commissioner Pulverenti, so we are doing a roll call vote.
Commissioner Freeman.
Yes.
Commissioner Curley. Yes. Commissioner Keezer.
Yes.
Chair Laley.
Yes.
Commissioner Martin.
No.
Commissioner Spaulding, yes. Commissioner Dickey.
No.
Commissioner Pulverenti.
Yes.
Commissioner Ding.
Yes.
Commissioner Vella. And I believe Commissioner Mullen tonight? Yes, thank you. I believe that's all our voting members for tonight. So in tally, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Affirmative, say it.
I have 9-2.
I'm much.
I have 9-2.
9-2, thank you. Math is hard.
A math major.
All right, so the motion is approved for the conditional use permit for the cannabis dispensary within existing commercial retail space and consideration of request for setback relief with the conditions put forward in the motion. Thank you to the applicant for the presentation. What I'm going to ask for now is that we take a 10-minute break. We will come back here at, say, 8:10 to start the next set of applications. Thank you. public audience. What we are going to do here is a little something different. We are combining 5, 6, and 7 since they are all on the same property and the applicant has requested to do one presentation. So please give me a moment while I read all three of them right now. And then when we make a motion, we will do it piece by piece because we do have to call out each APN and file number. So it's going to be a little bit of gymnastics here, but here we go. So file number PLP 17-0040, applicant name CSCF LLC Ryan Hayes, owner name Gordinger Turkey Farm Incorporated, site address 585 and 531 Trinity Road, Glen Ellen, APN 053-110-076. Project description, request for a planning project for a zone change to remove the mineral resource, MR, combining district, and a use permit for a 1 acre, 4,560 square foot of outdoor cannabis cultivation. The project site includes the former Trinity Quarry and will go through reclamation as part of this project. The parcel is 25.16 acres and is zoned LIA B6 100 LG/MNT RC50.50. Next file number, UPC 19-002. Applicant name, GDCF LLC Joseph E. Pearson, CSCF LLC Timothy Kreitz. Owner name, Gordinger Turkey Farm Incorporated. Site address, 101 Trinity Road, Glen Ellen. APN 053-110-001 and 053-130-009. Project description, request for a planning project for a use permit for 28,560 square foot of outdoor cannabis cultivation, 5,000 square foot of indoor wholesale cannabis nursery, 10,000 square foot of mixed light greenhouse, totaling 1 acre, 4,560 square feet of cannabis canopy area, and 9,640 square feet of propagation and vegetative production area, and 5,000 square feet of processing space under CSCF LLC. This application also includes a separate 20,000 square feet of centralized cannabis processing within a barn under GDCF LLC. The parcel area is approximately 20 acres and is zoned LIA B6 100 LG/MNT RC50-25 SR. Last but not least, file number UPC 17-0048, applicant name Terra Luna Farms LLC, owner name Lands of Gordinger Turkey Farms/Demeter, site address 12201 Highway 12, Glen Ellen, APN 053-130-009 and 053-100-15. Project description, request for a use permit for 4,560 square foot outdoor cannabis cultivation project on a 26.15 acre property zoned land intensive agriculture, LIA. The application includes an area up to 10,000 square feet for propagation and vegetative space fenced separately from the cultivation canopy. So those are the three projects we are going to listen to in one presentation. Please continue and let us know who you are.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that for me?
Yeah. Well done.
Good evening, Commissioners, Chairperson Laley, Councilmember Cook, good evening. And my name is Eric Pearson. I'm one of the applicants here. Tim Kreitz is another applicant.
If you wouldn't mind using the mic, because we do have a TV audience, and also it helps for notes.
Tim Kreitz is another applicant. Justin Morgan could not be here tonight. And then Sean Kelly is a co-applicant on one of the projects. There is a correction as far as Ryan Hayes on one of the projects, but when I get to that slide, I'll correct that. This project has been was submitted 3 years ago, so some of the applicants have changed since then. We've gone through the fire and all that stuff since then. So I also want to introduce Paula Blades here, in consultant for us, and is involved in one of the environmental impact reports. We had three different consultants for three different environmental impact reports, and their collectively those reports were analyzed together because the properties are contiguous with each other. We didn't bring a whole lot of public support here, but I just wanted to, it's not on the slides, but I wanted to briefly touch on public support. Trinity Oaks across the street, in early 2017, we had about 30 neighbors come and tour the property. I'll spare you the names and list of support, but there's about 15 or 20 names that are supportive from across the street. Julie and Tom Atwood, to our north, are supportive of the project, and are friends of ours. The Aliotos, Angela Alioto, who moved across the street to the south of us on Trinity, is a friend of ours. K-22 Ranch across the street is supportive. I think that's right, K-22. Eric Soule across the street, who lost his house in the fire, is a supporter. Margaret Goki directly across the street on Trinity is a supporter. The Martys had originally sent a letter in response to some sort of anti-cannabis folks who talked about guard towers and rifles and stuff. So we took them on a tour, and they are now supporters of the project as well. And the Beltanes, two properties to the north of us, are all supporters and friends of ours. We had a couple slides about who we are and our history and all that stuff, but I'll spare all that. Happy to answer questions about our organization afterwards if you like. Terra Luna Farms applicant, that was listed as Ryan Hayes in your packet. That's I'm the applicant there. We call the quarry farm is the reclamation that you're seeing there, so a zoning amendment to remove the MR overlay. That applicant is not here tonight, Justin Morgan, but I'm going to be presenting all three projects. And then the applicant, CSCF and WWCMC Incorporated, are the applicants for what we call the turkey parcel, which is the large parcel that has the greenhouse processing facility. And then another applicant on that is Sean Kelly and myself on that particular parcel. So there's three parcels, there's three applicants, there's three use permits, there's three environmental reports. All those EIRs reference each other, and were, you know, the environmental impact was analyzed collectively because of the shared water systems and the contiguous property lines that or borders of the property that share. The ranch is a 450-acre ranch. So next slide. All right, so about six commissioners came out to take a look, and we're more than happy to have commissioners, even if you vote tonight, if you guys want to come out later and take a look at the property, we'd love to show you. Let's see here. So I think not in this slide. Yeah, so in your handout, I believe, there's a map of all three projects together. Is that right? Is it in the handout? Do they have one? Okay, great. So that's looking at all three projects together. If we move to in order, as I described the applicants, the 1 acre project you can see here on the screen or on your page here, Terra Luna Farms, that's just 1 acre of cannabis on one 160 acre parcel. Okay. And then moving to the what we call the quarry, where we have reclaimed an active pit quarry. In order to remove the MR overlay in order to be allowed to cultivate cannabis under the zoning codes of Sonoma County. That's also 1 acre of cannabis on a 25-acre parcel, approximately 25 acres. And then the third use permit here is where most of the infrastructure and impact will occur. That is a 20,000 square foot processing barn and 70,000 square foot of glass house, greenhouse. That's not your plastic greenhouses. Those are glass Dutch style Venlo houses, quite expensive, really nice looking structures. To the street, it'll be a solid brown wall to Sonoma Highway. And we could talk more about how the light doesn't pollute and whatnot in a little bit. So moving right along. So water, security, traffic, odor, that's what I'm here to talk about. Water, just to put this in perspective, I know there's a, conventionally we hear a lot about how much water cannabis uses. It uses about twice as much water as grapes does per acre canopy, okay? So we're looking collectively here at about 3 acres of cannabis. We are approved for 8.1 acre feet of groundwater on this project. That is the equivalent of 6 acres of grapes, okay? 8.1 acre feet came from, collectively for all three projects. That was 2.2 acre feet for each acre of cannabis outdoor and 3.7 acre feet for the last parcel, which had a little bit of outdoor cannabis, but the greenhouse primarily. The greenhouse will also, and the processing barn will collect water in the winter off the roof in order to offset groundwater usage during the rainy months. So collectively 8.1 acre feet of water. And just, I'm not sure how familiar you are, but the water use for cannabis in Sonoma County is metered. So every project will have a water meter on it. There's an easement granted to the water meters to the county so they can come and inspect the meters. We have to report the meter readings quarterly. We also grant an easement to the county to the well that services the water tank that the pumps and the meters come off of so that they have access to check the condition of the well and the static levels of the water and whatnot. And we also have to check those static levels and report as to whether or not our groundwater is being diminished or whatnot as a result of our usage. If we go over those amounts by 20%, I think we talk to the county and try to figure out how to reduce it. Or if we go over up to 20%, anything over 20% of that, I believe you're back in front of the Planning Commission to talk about your water usage. So I guess to, not in the slides, but to back up, you know, we came onto this project in late 16, submitted permits in 17. The property was not in the best of shape. The quarry had been, was active, but had not been maintained. And so we've spent an incredible amount of money actually turning the pit quarry on what we call the quarry parcel here into a 9.6 acre feet lake pond. So we have a pond on the property now. It's quite nice for animals and biological activity. So that's water. I'm sure we'll talk about more about that later. Traffic. What's really awesome about this project is this is about as commercial as agricultural land can get. And what's really nice about it is we don't have to enter off of Sonoma Highway. Trinity Road borders the 450 acres to the south, Sonoma Highway to the west. So although there is a, you see the black line on the green parcel, that is a private drive that goes up to the second quarry on the parcel that's active. We do not use that driveway. That's for gravel trucks for the active quarry that's up there. Our entrance will be down on the south side of parcel two there off of Trinity Road, okay? We have a traffic study produced by WTrans. There's a whole bunch of statistics in there about the traffic, but you guys can read those and then ask questions later about that if you like. Security plan, that's sort of a joke. That's our guard bulldog, our guard bull. We have, so security, so all the outdoor cannabis is fenced. Within the fence, there's laser beams that wrap the perimeter. So if those beams are broken in the evening, that goes to an alarm system and we're notified that those have been broken. When the plants have flowers on them outdoors and are ready to be harvested, we have a security guard on site at night. So he would be notified if any of those beams would be broken. That security person is also roaming the property. Inside the greenhouse, and as required by state law, we would also have CCTV That's backed up as required by state law and is visible for, by the Bureau of Cannabis Control anytime. So CCTV in the processing barn in the greenhouse, as well as an alarm system, probably Bay Alarm, for burglar alarm systems on those buildings with your standard window breaks and door triggers and whatnot. And yeah, so that's security. That was that slide. And odor, I'll be real frank, you can't do much about the smell of outdoor cannabis. However, we have put these the acres of outdoor, they're set back quite a distance. The county has requirements about setbacks from sensitive uses, which aren't so prevalent in the valley, but you also have to be set back 300 feet from occupied homes. So we're set back quite a distance there for the outdoor. The greenhouses, you can't really carbon filter everything that comes out of a greenhouse, but you can add an odor neutralizing agent to the air that comes out of the greenhouse to neutralize that odor. Mind you, the greenhouse runs all year round, so you do have an odor present all year round from the greenhouses, whereas the outdoor, currently we have one harvest, but in the future we'll have two harvests because the genetics of cannabis allow us to harvest twice. It's complicated. I can talk about that later if you want. But anyhow, as far as the odor is concerned, in the processing barn, we really don't exchange air in the processing barn. Our barn is designed to be really high-tech, state-of-the-art, equivalent of a crush pad, processing center for other farmers, so they don't have to build these expensive facilities and they don't have to have these structures on their property. We're able to process cannabis for them in our barn, and we don't exhaust air out of that barn. We actually inject it with nitrogen in order to, it's a really high-tech way of curing cannabis on a commercial level. So we don't, and what air does leave that barn would go out of a charcoal filter, so the processing barn won't create any odor. Those are the four, that's the overview and the four points of concern. So I think with that, I'll just open it up to questions, if that's the right process here. Right?
Certainly, if that's all the presentation you'd like to give at this point.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. I turn it over to commissioners for questions. Yes, Commissioner Mullen.
On Terra Luna, I imagine you have a gate somewhere.
Yes.
Is it right out that Weiss Road or up the road
no,
somewhere?
No, so Terra, so all properties are, as far as vehicular traffic, they're all properties are accessed from Trinity Road. And there's a gate, yes.
Okay, so where you have the 20 parking stalls, that doesn't really, they can't really get onto Weiss Road from there?
They'll have to cross Weiss Road. So,
I understand what you're saying.
You travel north across
Parcel
2.
When I was up there, we saw how the cars came up. Okay,
yeah.
I got that.
Yeah.
And my other question would be, it says water supply. Are you going to be using that well also?
There's one well. There's a test well next to it so that we can monitor that well. That well, artesians when we're not using it, actually. It's a new well. That supplies 125,000-gallon water tank. 65,000 of that is reserved for the fire sprinkler systems that will be required inside the barn and the greenhouses.
Okay.
The rest will be used in all that's a central water system for all the uses.
Okay. And one last one. On page 9 on your odor, is that what the greenhouses are going to look like?
So that's all glass. You'll see.
But I mean that tall.
Yeah. They'll have to stay underneath, I think, 30 feet or something.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. They won't be. Actually, the sidewalls will be 16 feet, roughly. Is that right, Tim? About 16 feet. And I think the peaks will probably be another 6 feet or so. So about 22, 23 feet.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, I think that picture is hard to tell. We just kind of put that picture in to show what a Venlo greenhouse looks like.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Spaulding.
I am so confused.
Okay.
First of all, we've got name changes from the original. Whatever happened to GDCF? They no longer exist.
The corporate entity does exist.
Eric, let me just cut to a chase here.
Yeah.
Because I can't tell who owns what exactly and who is responsible for what, my real concern is you have shared, you have some shared resources. The water power, I believe, is all coming into
Well, so the outdoor facilities have their own, the two outdoor facilities have their own power.
Okay.
Yeah.
The philosophical question, if you will, is on behalf of the county, if there's a problem, especially, for example, on the well, who's responsible?
Well, there's easements required in order to, for the water to cross the other property lines.
But the well itself,
uh-huh.
Who actually owns the well?
The Gordinker, the
okay,
family
Okay, so
does.
It's the site, yeah, all right, the yeah. owner of the property.
That's correct.
So if there were a problem with the well, it would go first to the Gordinkers and then
no,
you
it,
would...
No, it would go to us.
The lawyers the would argue about it, okay.
Well, no, we would fix it's our responsibility in the lease.
Okay, all yeah. right, it's covered by the lease. You see what I'm saying? Is
well,
just,
also, yeah, I mean, tenant improvements and what... It's a little bit complicated. There's some tenant improvements that the family has made for us because
right.
they had fire proceeds and
right,
they would
right, right,
recapture
right.
depreciation and all that good stuff. But there's also tenant improvements that we have made and we'll be responsible for. We look after everything on the property, though.
So if... Hold on, I did have another question. I would like it, if I would have liked for the purpose of this presentation if we could add a little more clarity as to who owns what and mm-hmm. is doing what with it. So you have two grow facilities and a grow plus processing.
Yes, that's correct.
So there are three grow areas
yeah.
and one has the central processing that will, yeah. they will process for everybody
they
will,
yeah,
on
the
this
central
property
processing will process for everything off this property plus anyone from the public who wants to process cannabis there.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna stop for now and think.
Sure.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Martin.
Shirley, your hydrology report from PJC, are you using that or are we
yes.
in our discussions here?
Yes, that's
okay.
What, that's how, that, yes.
All right. In that report, it said you have five wells on site right now and that you're going to drill another well 400 feet deep. Is that still in the plans?
That well's been drilled.
That well?
That 400-foot well has been drilled. We drilled it 420 feet.
But I'm sorry. You will drill it, or you have
it's been
done
drilled.
It.
Done.
You
it's
already
been
done it. I'm sorry. You're going to have to speak in the mic. I have
okay.
a hard time hearing. The other thing is your cultivated impact area, meaning, am I correct? No, there's wherever you draw water from, that would be part of that area. Is that correct?
I don't understand that question.
In that report, it says that the cultivated impact area, I should say, is the term, is 800 acres.
Okay.
Which stretches beyond your 200 and some acres mm-hmm. that covers all of your three parcels, meaning you're going to be drawing water from neighbors.
No. I don't believe, so I can answer this. My understanding of the hydrology report is that we cannot have an impact. We have to demonstrate that we will not have an impact on the neighbor and surrounding wells. And our hydrologist had to demonstrate that through a report in which Robert Pennington, the county's hydrologist, had to sign off on, essentially.
But then what is this 800? It's important, the 800 acres, because you use it in the calculation of how many acre feet you're going to produce. Down below, you say...
Well, I respectfully can't answer. I don't know the details of that.
If I may interrupt, Commissioner Martin, Commissioner Carr, did you have something to add to that?
Typically, what the hydrology reports require is a finding that the proposed operation will not have a cumulative impact on wells in the surrounding area. And so what Mr. Pennington does, he's the county staff hydrologist, what he does is, using his geologic maps and everything, is chooses an area that's within what he defines as the cumulative impact area. That's probably, I haven't read the report, but that's probably the 800 acre area. And so there are other wells and other properties that sit on that. So what the challenge is to show that the water use from this project will not affect other wells within that area.
I see. So using the 800 acres, however, there's a commentary in that report that well casings vary between 40 and 330 feet in length. And therefore, This is a quote, therefore the average thickness of the saturated aquifer is conservatively assumed to be approximately 135 feet. How is that calculated? I mean, I'm a layman, and this doesn't make any sense, particularly if you're making assumptions to come up with a number, because in the next paragraph, you multiply the 800 acres times that number to come up with the number of acre feet or gallons that you're going to produce per year. I don't understand that phrase. Therefore, the average thickness of the saturated aquifer is conservatively assumed to be approximately 135 feet. How did we get 135?
I think Andrew could probably answer some of these questions.
Hi, Andrew Dobbs Kramer, and I've interfaced extensively with our hydrologist as well as with Mr. Pennington.
If you could speak closer to the mic, thank you.
Sorry, I think the number you're referring to is a measurement of the storativity of the entire aquifer. And they're talking about the depth of the entire aquifer and saying that it extends over an 800-acre expanse. So that is not specific to this project, and the water that is going to be drawn will come from 800 acres. That is merely saying that we are tapping into a very large aquifer that is underlying the entire Sonoma volcanics. I believe that's what that is in reference to.
Through the chair, if the 800 acres is the lateral estimate, the 135 feet is the vertical estimate.
But they don't explain how they calculated 135.
Well, you might have to sit in for a lengthy.
Well, they say they conservatively assume.
So there are wells that are 60 feet deep that are drawing water, and there are ones that are 200 feet deep. Right. So therefore, the difference of 130 feet, they're showing that that's what they think the aquifer.
But they have not stated they've measured that. They state that they're assuming it's 135. And we're dealing with a pretty serious subject here. Now, another point is that that the groundwater demand that you, 1 acre of outdoor cultivation on the two parcels, 1 and 3, will use 1 acre foot a year. That's according to your report. And on parcel 2, it'll use 1.5 acre feet per year. Now, Mr. Carr just mentioned Mr. Pennington, who is the geologist for the PRMD, and he has very different numbers, that indoor grow is 4 acre feet per year, and outdoor grow is 2 acre feet per year. So that's a significant difference in the amount of water to be used. It comes to about 814,000 gallons, or 2.5 acre feet. I don't, where do these numbers come from?
So that draft you're looking at, I believe, is the original hydrology report, and Mr. Pennington commented on that and asked that more conservative numbers be used to estimate the potential total groundwater use. And so that report was revised with updated numbers of 2.2 acre feet per outdoor parcel and 3.7 for the central turkey greenhouse parcel. So that accommodated for his increased, I believe you said it was 4 acre feet per acre of greenhouse. So with the actual amount of greenhouse on that parcel, 3.7 accounts for his numbers. So there was a revised hydrogeology report conducted after that one, and then an additional supplement before we could get Mr. Pennington sign off, as well as you'd see on slide 6. Our hydrogeologist not only analyzed the current conditions, but also analyzed potential total build out of other potential cannabis uses in the area, other potential existing vineyard demand in the area, as well as existing and potential domestic groundwater use in the area. This doesn't seem to be explained.
I have a hard time. Am I understanding that Mr. Pennington has reviewed your numbers and approved them?
Yes.
Okay.
It wasn't easy.
Three rounds.
I'll hold my comments for other comments.
Thank you. Yes, Commissioner Freeman.
So on the water monitoring, who is it that inspects from the county? Who does the inspecting?
I'm not sure who actually goes out and does the measurement, but Mr. Pennington is the hydrologist on the county staff. Either he does it himself, or he asks the, you know, requires that the applicant do it, or
do the reporting.
Yeah.
Sorry, this is a sidebar kind of, because
it's okay.
I understand they started monitoring wells, or we have started monitoring wells. Have we staffed up as a community, as a county, to actually handle that monitoring, or is it all self-regulated?
It's pretty much self-regulated, but okay. Water agency, for example, monitors wells. The staff monitors some. What you're seeing now is a ramp up because of the groundwater sustainability agencies that have been established that are responding to the state law requiring groundwater management. Mm-hmm. So you're seeing the county, Mr. Pennington and the county staff ramp up the monitoring. You're seeing a more conservative approach to analyzing projects. That's where Mr. Pennington's numbers come from. So far, every applicant for cannabis has been proposed less than what Mr. Pennington requires that they analyze. So okay. He's, you know, a more conservative estimate. You're also seeing the water agency, county water agency, ramping up their monitoring. But there's no groundwater sustainability plan yet. So the actual formal adoption of the plan is still a couple of years away. And that will have, undoubtedly, will have very strict monitoring requirements so that the county can prove to the state that groundwater is being sustainably managed.
Thank you for that education. I appreciate it. Sorry to put you through that, but we need a little bit of information too. So I have one other question, and that's about kind of your security plan as it relates to the lasers and
yes.
what have you. I'm probably wrong here, but will they go off if a raccoon crosses the...
Yeah, they're inside the fence line.
Right.
Yeah, and then so they're, I think they're about, well, I know they're about this high. So the fence is out here. They're about 4 feet inside the fence.
Okay.
And it's a pain in the butt.
I guess the question is whether there's the potential here for them to go off
yes, there
on
is.
A regular basis, not due to intrusion from... someone trying to
it happens it's like a leaf yeah. usually
so is there an internal mechanism for you guys to respond to that before it goes to yeah. our services as a county? That's my question.
Yes, yeah, so that actually goes to our alarm company, and okay. then our alarm company notifies a series of people, one head of security first, and then boom 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 down the list.
Okay.
So we have our own way. Resources will not be responding to false alarms.
Thank you. That's what I was yeah. basically getting at. Thank you.
If I could piggyback off of your question, how close is your head of security to the location itself? Should said leaf or squirrel run through the laser
yeah,
fence or something
Santa
larger?
Santa Rosa right now.
Okay.
I'd have housing there for him.
That was going to be my next question.
Yeah, they all burned down. There's like four houses that burned down.
Okay. So. Mr. Carr, if I can ask you a question as well. With the standards that are going through with the groundwater, is that something that once that policy is adopted, the people previous to that will be kind of grandfathered into those previous uses, or it affects every single person, so everyone will have to come into compliance with something like that?
No. People that get their approval beforehand, I assume, will be grandfathered in. Of course, if you have a permit that terminates and then there's a review and you come back, you can bring them into compliance in the future, but that's not everybody. So, you know, there are many applicants that they've got their well and they're good to use it.
If I may add, Chairperson.
Yes.
These are not entitlements. So, you know, build at your own risk, your greenhouse, your processing center. These are not entitlements. They do not run with the land. They're permits. So we actually have to come back and get permission to use the greenhouse in 5 years. We hope to be able to change that legislatively, but that's the way it is now.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Since we're on the topic of permits, so you're seeking these permits now. Are we going to see you in a year or two with something else as it relates to this property? I'm just curious. Any future ideas that you have?
We have big plans, but right now this is all we're allowed to do. Under the current legislation, we're pretty much tapped out on what we're
thank you for that. Legally appreciate it.
Yes, Commissioner Ding.
And also is a water issue.
Yes.
And here you mentioned about 50% of an annual recharge.
Yes.
How you can get this kind of the percentage?
Andrew. I can make an educated guess, but he'll be better at that.
Yeah, so this is, again, based on Mr. White, our hydrogeologist's estimation of the aquifer, as well as the surface area overlaying that aquifer, and I believe infiltration rates. It's a very detailed study. As I asked more and more questions about this, I was told that I was going into PhD level hydrogeology and aquifer analysis. So I think that's a fairly conservative number he's based it on in order to get Mr. Pennington sign off.
So now I think that it should be so-called voluntary or is not required, right, 50% recharge.
I'm sorry.
Here now you said in the 50% recharge, but you said and a scholar and a study to find out this in a number. But I'm wondering, is this number required or you voluntary or is possible you can increase this in a number? Or what kind of a measure you can reach?
Yeah, so the usage number is limited through the use permit. So if you go over this usage, you're back before the BZA explaining why. And it's checked annually through the groundwater monitoring easements and the monthly data that's submitted to the county. So if there is an increase over that 50%, it'll be triggered by an over-usage and a meter dinging and a hearing in front of BZA.
Do you have existing facilities to and reach this kind of the goal?
We do have one existing tank on site.
Okay.
There are additional tanks proposed at each of the outdoor facilities for fire backup.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions from commissioners? Yes, Commissioner Martin.
Calabasas Creek is how far away from your property?
Andrew, how far is Calabasas Creek? Seven or 800 feet.
Okay. Now, that's an annual, that creek runs year-round, correct?
It does.
Okay. And there is a friend of mine at the Ecology Center put me on a website called Bay Area Lands .org Explorer, and when you draw your property up on the screen, it covers all the bay, but then you can pinpoint and bring up certain properties, and yours comes up as a marginal groundwater area. Now, that seems to me to be kind of onerous to have that, and it also makes a comment that it's an area essential to conservation goals that we should be conserving. And it seems to me that Calabasas Creek, which is so close to you, that if there's any kind of flow of awful material that comes from the growth process is going to get into the watershed and cause problems downstream. And if you just simply saw, that's a very important point, was or even our publisher of our local paper last Friday talked about Sonoma Creek and how it was at one time being a place for spawning steelhead trout and coho salmon. You have a very important responsibility up there of maintaining that property without having it influence or damage nearby watershed. I think it's truly an important point.
I agree. We actually farm biodynamically, and we're certified by Demeter, which is the certification company that certifies biodynamics. So
you were certified by whom?
Demeter, which is the company that certifies biodynamic farming. So we use no chemicals. We use only organic sourced products and nutrients that are locally sourced. So biodynamic is basically organic, but also contemplates the process in which you grow organically. So for example, you can grow organically and you can get your sphagnum moss from Canada or your peat from Canada and your cocoa fiber from Sri Lanka. But at the end of the day, you have a very large carbon footprint. So if you get certified biodynamically, you actually are organic as an underlining standard, and you're also sourcing your inputs locally. As far as the water and the runoff, we very much agree and are concerned. We have meters and we have gauges that tell us how much to water our plants. And we're very concerned about runoff, not for twofold. We have a limited amount of water that we can use. So, you know, we're not interested in water running off anywhere, because we only have so much water that we're allowed to use in the first place.
Okay. Another point is that ever since I moved to Sonoma, people speak of the wildlife corridor across the valley. Well, I did a little research into that to find out where is this corridor exactly. Well, it ends up that it's the culverts and the places that allow the animals to get under Highway 12 and so forth. And also there have the elimination of barriers of movement. Yep. You have 8-foot fences with motion lights at all corners and motion lights over all of your cultivation. It seems to me that that is a barrier to any kind of normal migration of wildlife.
I can speak to that. So that the outdoor cannabis farms are surrounded by a square fence, the actual space itself, not the 450-acre parcel. So the 450-acre parcel has cattle fencing all over it, but that's only about, you know, 4 or 5 feet, 3 to 4 feet tall. Our fencing is 5-foot deer and rabbit fencing with two wires on top that make it a total of 7 feet. That's not barbed wire. There's no barbs on them in case the deer hit them, because the mountain lions like to use fencing to corner them. But our fences are square, but they're not like linear all the way across the property where it would actually affect that migration. If you're on one corner of the fence, an animal, I would assume, or at least a human, can see the other corner of the fence to get around it. So we're not zigzagging the property. We're just putting squares directly around the acre of cannabis. The acre of cannabis actually takes about 2.2, 2.3 acres of fenced-in area in order to get that 1 acre of canopy. So you're talking about a box. I can't do the math right now, but about 200 square foot box, 300 square foot box, 300 by 300. That surrounds a couple acres, 90,000 feet or so.
I don't know. I got the idea that you had the 8-foot fence around the whole property.
No, sir.
From reading the report.
No, sir. We have a deer and rabbit fence we're working on. We've put about a half mile in since the fire's been, and have more to put in for the cattle and whatnot. And then we also have some fencing along Trinity Road that we need to put in, because folks, you know, come off and camp on the property and stuff. But okay. We're pretty conscious of that. We like our mountain lions that hang out there, and we're building a lake to have biological activity and animals and stuff like that too.
Is there a wildlife crossing under 12 in that, alongside that property?
Well, it would be Calabasas Creek if there's Calabasas a culvert there. There's also a culvert on this Calabasas, right? I pronounce it wrong sometimes. There's a culvert on what we call the turkey parcel. So where the greenhouses are, so between the greenhouses and Sonoma Highway, there's another culvert, because there's a little a tributary called, we call it McGinty Creek, on the property that actually has a culvert under Sonoma Highway.
Okay, yeah. Thanks.
Any other questions from commissioners? Yes, please, Commissioner Dean.
Margaret, Commissioner Spaulding, touched on an interesting subject. So I'd like to ask some questions related to that subject, if I might. So you've combined basically three projects into one for a presentation.
Correct.
There are a multitude of entities that are represented, however, in this application.
Correct.
So are you all of those entities, or are those entities not represented here?
No.
And I understand, so you pointed at this gentleman to your right.
Yeah.
So what's the pointing to the guy to your right?
Well, I want to go back to the combined project overview slide.
because that's the best way to describe this. Okay, so, and the reason there's a lot of confusion is because this started one way 3 years ago. We lost our entire farm to the fires. The rules have changed since then. The county's direction as far as ownership, transfer of ownership, yada, 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 is a disaster.
Ownership, not of the property itself, but of the corporate entities. Okay.
So if we go back to better explain and to answer Commissioner Spaulding's question, hopefully more clear. So that first property, which is the 160-acre parcel, 1 acre of outdoor, Terra Luna Farms is the corporate name. Okay. The applicant is myself. Okay. The second 1 acre of property, or the second 1 acre of cannabis on the 25-acre quarry parcel, okay, Justin Morgan, who's not here. And Tim is the applicant on the cultivation located on the turkey parcel. And then I am the applicant along with Sean here on the processing barn itself.
Okay, so basically there are two grow areas and then the cultivation plant. I mean, the industrial portion of it, if you will.
That's correct, yes. Okay. Yeah, you've got two outdoor farms on two separate parcels, and then the industrial portion is your greenhouse, a little bit of outdoor, and your processing center. Yes.
And which project is responsible for the restoration of the quarry that we viewed?
Yeah, so that's the quarry farm.
Okay.
PLP 17004.
I can be stopped at any time if I ask questions that are impertinent. But obviously there are liabilities that are different for each one of these partnerships, these LLCs. And I would assume, and correct me if I'm wrong, the restoring the quarry is probably far more expensive and for that entity than perhaps just planting the 1 acre. And I would assume that the industrial part of this is obviously very expensive as well.
Yeah, and just on the quarry, on the reclamation, that's done. So that's signed off by Robert Pennington. It's 95% done. Reclamations aren't done until you monitor invasive species and the replanting of native vegetation for a period of 5 years after the majority of the work is done. So the quarry reclamation is, for the most part, is done. There's an updated reclamation plan that's been submitted to Robert Pennington. He's approved that. He has to also send that to the state. They have to sign off on that. And that's been approved and the work's been done.
So when you, do those things have to be approved before you're given your use permit?
Yes, is the short answer. And the process is the reclamation has to be approved by the county and mostly done before the zoning overlay, MR, which stands for mineral resource, mm-hmm. can be removed. County code does not allow the cultivation of cannabis on an MR overlay. So part of the hearing that we'll have in front of the Board of Supervisors will not only ask to approve the use permits, but we'll ask for a zoning, an amendment to the zoning of that particular parcel to remove that MR overlay at the same time, and then never again will a quarry.
And then the reclamation was the give back for the mineral.
It's required to reclaim and to be substantially reclaimed before you can have the MR removed. It's required to have the MR overlay removed before you can put cannabis on the property.
So are there any requirements that are similar for the additional 1 acre cultivation site?
Specific to the reclamation?
Yeah, I mean, no. Was there anything for restoration of any sort associated with that?
No, not related to the cannabis. The restoration that's related to reclaiming the quarry and getting the state to sign off.
I understand that. I mean, you have two cultivation sites. Mm-hmm. So the second cultivation site, which is held by a different partner.
Myself, yes.
That also, did it have any requirements to achieve its,
No, it's a separate parcel, so it didn't have the, related to the quarry, no, because it's a separate parcel.
Okay, understood.
But yeah, no, nothing other than, all these requirements the county makes you do for an acre of cannabis.
Right, okay. And then finally, I'm kind of curious about the family itself.
Yeah.
You know, there, I assume there are multiple entities.
No, there's one entity, Gordenker Turkey Farms, Inc.
Well, I mean, but they're family members. So,
there's different members of the corporation.
Are they all supportive of this
effort?
Yeah,
they are, yeah. So Lenore's 95. funny story if you want to hear it. She's sure. Amazing. She snuck out of the house on New Year's with her 92-year-old boyfriend and got in a traffic accident in Petaluma. I spent an hour with Sylvia today. So Lenore Gordenker, the old man Gordenker died in 2004, Russian immigrants. She's 95. She's the matriarch of the family. There's three daughters. There's Sylvia Gordenker, or Bernard, who is the one who takes care of everything. There's Peter Gordenker, a single man who lives back on Nuns Canyon on the ranch, the original home is on Nuns Canyon where the fire started in 17. And then there's Christine Gordenker, and she's in Santa Rosa. And then Sylvia has two daughters, Michelle, who manages the ranch as well, and Andrea. And then Christine has a daughter, Felicia, with a boyfriend and one kid. We know them well. They're great people.
I mean, so currently it's largely cattle. There are no more turkeys, obviously. Vineyards on this.
There's six
property.
Acres of cab, Moon Mountain cab, okay. On the large parcel that my 1 acre is on.
Okay.
The family makes their own wine out of that.
And is any of the water that's been spoken of to be used in conjunction with that vineyard, or is that separate?
There, it's on a different well. There are four or five other wells in the property. We only use the new well that we dug.
And was that part of the water study, their
yes.
use of that water?
Yeah, we had to dig up and find those well logs and
okay.
all that stuff, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Just Thank a you. Quick follow-up, if
yes.
I can, Mr. Chair. So, as I understand, as the project goes forward, each of the separate parcels can be acted on differently if
mm-hmm.
the county wants to do that.
That's correct.
You can say, we like number one and number three, but we don't like number two.
Yep.
And the processing is an issue, and Mr. Pearson's processing project is the first one. We have not yet seen one come to the BZA for hearing process where a processor is using, you know, basically an organized cultivation area in the surrounding parcels.
Yeah.
So that'll be the first time.
We were in front of Commissioner Carr last summer when we advocated to allow processing in ag land. The rules before last summer said you had to ship your cannabis up to Airport Boulevard to have it processed, and so technically we would not have been able to use one barn for all three parcels. So unless we had a processing license, that's a state designation, which means you are allowed to take cannabis from another parcel or another owner. So that's where the processing started. In conversations and talking with the community, I've organized a lot of the community and the other businesses. Processing is the bottleneck. Their F1 occupancies, their fire sprinklers, their ADA parking. Contrary to popular belief, this industry is not flush with money. It's almost bankrupt for the most part. The state's program is in disarray. Anything that can be done to help sort of normalize the industry and to create efficiencies like other industries have is something that's I believe is enormously beneficial. So providing a barn like this with the high technology that we have for processing and drying and storing cannabis will be a project that will actually really benefit a lot of farmers in the area, that they don't have to build that infrastructure and that capital expenditure to try to dry an acre of cannabis.
Yes, Commissioner Spaulding.
Thank you. So this is a prototype, in a way, your processing facility and the way it's sited.
It's the first one. Yeah.
That makes it a prototype.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner Carr, are there questions we should be asking about that facility that we don't know anything about yet?
Well, I don't. No, not necessarily. I think the issue that gave rise to the original legislation that restricted processing is just a concern that a lot of community members spoke about with respect to wineries. You're seeing a lot of large processing buildings and structures on agricultural lands, and so when cannabis first came down the pike and people started talking about, well, can't we do processing for cannabis? I think the fear was that there would be a lot of more large buildings, on agricultural land, and that might be that might detract from, you know, the rural lifestyle, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And when the second round came through and several of the applicants came forward and said, well, you know, why should we have three separate processing buildings on three adjoining parcels? And that doesn't make a lot of sense either. So I think we dipped our toe in it a little bit. I think we said there we're going to try
nine.
Yeah, because there's nine planning areas. So we.
Well, I think you defaulted to the number of dispensaries.
In we used nine for the number of dispensaries. So I think we just, after about an hour of arguing, we just said, why don't we just put a limit on the number of joint processing facilities and let's see how it goes. And so this is the first one of those. So I think maybe if you have a question about whether or not you think the processing side of this operation is overly large for some reason or another, or dominates the, is too much for agricultural, for rural agricultural property, you might ask that question or be concerned.
Oh, can you make it look more like a pretty barn? I'm sorry, I'm being facetious. It's getting late.
It's brown. I don't know what else to do with it. We had to do it in Bradford.
It won't be visible, though, from...
Well, we're required to plant on the outside of it, but it is brown, and you got all those live oaks between it and Sonoma Highway. A couple things. In LIA land, and you cannot build a greenhouse for cannabis or a processing barn or any structures for cannabis unless you offset the permeable soil. So what made this property so unique was 100,000 square foot of old concrete slabs. And then the fire came through and we got FEMA to take away the slabs. But we documented all that impermeable surface, and we have a surface, and we have to offset. So that's why the greenhouse is limited to 70,000 feet. In the barn, we aren't using any more soil than was. You got that. Okay. And then the other thing with processing, it has to be only for locally sourced product. And we didn't really define that, but we assume that that's going to look like grapes, which is probably within the. I think grapes is actually Napa and Mendocino. We expect it to be Sonoma County where we source our cannabis. And then the size, to touch on the size of the barn, to dry an acre of cannabis, 43,560 square feet, you need 5,000 square foot of barn, okay? Now, at any given time. And cannabis harvests, different strains harvest over a period of 45 days, so you have more capacity than just whatever that is, you know, at a flash point. But it does take a lot of space to dry cannabis.
Yes, Commissioner Dickey.
Could you discuss a little bit about the processing? Is it noisy? We talked about odors. Yeah. What about noise? What about light? What about traffic coming and going at night, for instance?
Yeah.
What are those sorts of impacts?
I'll touch on those for the greenhouse as well as the processing. So noise, there's really none. There's a chiller on the outside of the building. We don't use large fans. We don't move air in and out of the processing facility. We dehumidify that air, and we condition it, and we add nitrogen to the process. So there'll be a chiller on the outside of the building that'll hum. It's not very loud. There's no massive fans moving that in and out. As far as light is concerned, the processing barn has no exterior lighting other than security lighting. All lighting is required to be downlit if you're a cannabis business. And as far as light in the greenhouse goes, we have supplemental lighting. So we're all renewable energy, as required by law. Only our industry is. And so we have LED lighting in the greenhouses to supplement the lighting. And so when that lighting goes on, sometimes in the evening when the sun is down, the blackout shades in the greenhouse close so that there's no light pollution between sunset and sunrise. Yeah, will we talk about traffic?
I think Commissioner Freeman had a question. Did you have a?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask the, and this might be directed towards you, sir. This seems like to me, you know, I drive around this county quite a bit, and I don't see a lot of places where I go, oh, there's marijuana growing over there. How does this compare with, do we have a lot of land being used for outdoor grows at this point? I'm just curious.
We do have some, but I can't tell you where they are.
I was just going to say, I don't want to know where. I'm just curious because, you know, you said from the perspective of the actual processing, that's a new thing. I have no idea what legally is being grown out there.
Right.
And so I just am curious on some level.
Well, I was just going to add to what Eric was saying, that there is quite a bit of processing going on in industrial zones in the county unincorporated area as well as in the cities. Okay. And actually, I've sat on several of those. There are several in South Santa Rosa area. There's some up at the airport. And there's others that are coming through. So I don't think it doesn't look to me, at least in this initial stage, like we're going to see a whole bunch of processing on agricultural lands for cannabis. But at one point, we were told that there were hundreds of cannabis grow applications coming through a couple of years ago, and now there just don't seem to be that many. And I think that Eric may have hit on it a little bit with the changing economics and everything. But there hasn't been a rush to come to the county for more processing on the individual. We had one processing, I think it was the West Petaluma one had processing on the site. We've had probably 7 or 8 outdoor grows come through the county that have been approved. About half of them appealed, mostly just grows ranging in size. Not as many acres as this at one time.
Thank you for giving me that flavor.
Yeah,
I'm just
really
curious.
Just uncertain is this shifting projection by the department about how many grows are coming through the application process. A lot of them are dropping out because of the economics.
The economics are good. So. If I may add one
yes.
thing, I think it's important. Come April, hemp, it's the same plant, is legal in Sonoma County to plant. There is no restriction on the water usage. There is no restriction on the setback from sensitive uses or property lines. There is no restriction on the acreage and the amount that you can plant, and it smells and looks and walks and talks the same as cannabis. So I think that's just something to kind of keep in perspective.
Thank you. Commissioner Mullen.
You said earlier that this is a prototype. Did you mean anywhere in the world or just here?
Commissioner Spaulding said prototype.
Yeah.
I said first of a kind.
First
and then
of a
she
kind.
Said that's a prototype.
So is it first of a kind anywhere? Or
No. Colorado went first.
Okay.
You know, and there's thousands of acres.
Okay.
And they
gotcha.
Have massive hemp processing.
You
barns
just mean here.
Yeah. They process hemp now. Well, one of the ways we'll be processing it, we will just pull it out of the field and we will freeze it. That's how you do it when it goes to extraction, which is a different use. Processing is drying cannabis. Manufacturing is the extraction of oil from cannabis, not on this property.
Thanks.
Commissioner Martin, then Commissioner Ding.
Yes, your document states that you have submitted CEQA reports. They've been prepared, but have they been approved by CEQA?
Technically,
if you wouldn't mind telling us who you are.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank
I'm Paula
you.
Blades. I'm a land use planning consultant. And technically, there are mitigated negative declarations. They're not actually EIRs. And there's one for each of the three parcels and projects. And they're in process right now. There's been a number of studies to support the traffic study, the hydrogeology reports, biology, all of those are going into review, and cultural resources as well. All of the different topics are covered. And those are going to be referenced. They'll be attached to the mitigated negative declarations, but that's a process that we're in progress right now.
Thank you. I had one more question. That was, you mentioned that the water will be metered. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's all 3 meters. 3 projects, 3 meters.
Nice. Thank you.
Commissioner Ding.
Majorly, you're on the growing. And also, you mentioned about you want to sell, and that is in the wholesale. How to define the wholesale?
So I think I understand the question. There's no selling of cannabis off any of these parcels. So are you asking about how the cannabis moves and where the transaction occurs?
But the reports I saw that you also, one of the, and the second one, I think, and also you have the commercial sale, and also that is mentioned about the wholesale.
I think I understand your question, yes. Yeah. So the farms that produce cannabis are businesses that wholesale cannabis, required to wholesale cannabis to what's called a distributor. And then distributors actually take the cannabis, package it up, test it, okay? Hold it for the test to come back to make sure it's clear of contaminants. And then those distributors distribute it to retailers who have licenses to sell it to the public. None of that occurs on this property. Basically, we cultivate cannabis, and then it goes into a barn, and then it goes to our 25,000 square foot facility in Santa Rosa, where we actually manufacture, package it, label it, and distribute it to other businesses wholesale and to our five retail outlets that we operate.
Okay, so there basically no any business transaction in your property?
No transactions on the property, no money on the property.
Okay, thank you. Another one is the, you mentioned about you want to remove mineral resource MR combining district. That is, I really don't understand. So maybe you can tell me a little bit.
I can tell you a little bit, and then
Greg and in the consequence, if removed, if any in the gold or the precious and the mineral in the underground.
I think most people in the county will jump in joy that there's no MR overlay there because it means no more quarry, no more active mining of rock out of the property. The neighboring parcel still has an active quarry, still has an MR overlay. But this property, with the removal of the MR overlay, means that no rock can be mined from the property anymore. It used to be an old, it's really gorgeous, you know, it's called California gold, the crushed rock that comes off this property. A lot of Sonoma County, Sonoma Valley has rock from this particular property. It comes out layered in sheets, and it was used and mined out of the pit a long time ago as flagstone. But now it doesn't make financial sense to do that, so.
All right, thank you for your education.
Yeah.
Any other questions from commissioners? Okay.
Okay,
thank you. I'm gonna open this up for public comment now. And please tell us who you are, and I will give you 3 minutes.
Good evening again. Kathy Pons, Valley of the Moon Alliance from Kenwood. I'm just a little confused, like you all, with the parcels. Looking back at the Turkey Farm file, there was a notice of a waiver of hearing for a use permit for one of the parcels at 12201 Sonoma Highway, which was to extend the mining footprint for a maximum of 20 more years on the 28.1 acres parcel. And looking at trying to compare the parcel numbers, there is the address is the same as the one on number 7, and that parcel number, or one of the parcel numbers, is the same as the one that's on this application. And this application was published on May 22, 2019. So that kind of makes me wonder whatever happened to this one. But anyway, so, you know, I'm just curious if there will be continued mining at the quarry, or has that just been totally dropped? Also curious how deep the well is that is providing all the water. He mentioned growing hemp, which is the same, and I just wondered if there is a problem with growing hemp next to cannabis because of, I don't know, maybe somebody can tell me that answer. The other question I had is the processing facility will be drying the cannabis, but it's almost sounded like he was going to take in other farmers and help dry their cannabis too. So how much of that is going to be? I mean, I didn't do the math with the 5,000 square foot barn for 1 acre of cannabis, but you know, how many of these other people are going to be coming by to drop off their weed and then get it processed again, you know? So I was just curious about that. But anyway, that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay. Seeing none, I'm closing public comment. Okay, so commissioners, conversation, motion, and since we heard three applications in one presentation, we will have to be very specific. I personally think, after we have our conversations, that we go file number by file number and do motions. I think that'll be the easiest and the cleanest. I'm up to suggestions for that, but I think that'll just keep everything above board. Before we get there, though, I am actually, Ms. Pons did bring up a question that I had and I forgot to ask, which if Mr. Pearson, if you could come back up, how many people are how many cult other people are you expecting to deliver product to your cultivation site?
I don't know yet. There's one particular farm that's come in front of you, application at Doug Gardner up on Cave Dell Road. I think you guys denied because of water. He'll be back, I believe, and he wants us to cultivate, you know, to dry his cannabis. Obviously, building a barn on Cave Dell Road is, you know, quite a thing. So just to bring it down the hill. I'm happy to answer the other questions.
Yeah, I believe the well is 400 feet. Is
yeah,
that
the well is 420 feet deep. And just to clarify on the quarry, so the cannabis the quarry farm. Okay, it's called quarry farm because we're reclaiming that particular quarry. There's another active quarry. There's five parcels here, so we're on three of them. There's a fourth parcel with a 28-acre parcel with an active quarry on it. That is the same owner, but has a quarry operator on it. That rock comes down Weiss Road, and is not a road that we use. And that's I think the county just issued a new 20-year use permit on that. But that's same property, but that's not us.
Okay.
And I think there was a question about.
Let me just, if I could, Mr. Chairman, just add to that. That use permit simply allows the existing use to continue for more time. It doesn't add any more intensity to the quarry use.
That's been happening.
Thank you for that clarification. And then hemp versus cannabis.
Yeah, there's no difference in the plant. There's a significant difference in the way it's regulated. I could, in April, plant 100 acres of hemp on this property. And I would have 3 acres of cannabis with easements for the monitoring of the water and, you know, security cameras and all these things, traffic studies, so on and so forth. And the 100 acres of hemp would have no scrutiny at all. So we don't plan to plant hemp on the property. I think we're going to plant maybe an acre or two this year. But that's not our core business.
Thank you. Commissioners. Comments, motions. Seeing no comments, well, do I have a motion? Let's start with the first one here, file number PLP17-0040, which is the quarry farm, as it was called in their presentation. So request for a planning project for a zone change, the mineral resource combining district, and use permit for 1 acre of outdoor cannabis cultivation.
I move we recommend approval of item number, file number three. File number five, I'm sorry.
We have a second from Ms. Vella. Why don't we go ahead and do roll call? I'm going to make you do roll call for all these. I apologize.
No problem. It's my job. Commissioner Freeman.
Yes.
Commissioner Curley.
Yes.
Commissioner Keezer.
Yes.
I'd like to offer an amendment.
We've already started voting. Can we do an amendment? I need some advice here. I apologize, Mr. Martin. Since we've already started voting, we cannot do an amendment.
I'm sorry.
We cannot do an amendment because the voting has already started.
Right.
Chairman Lely?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Abstain.
Commissioner Spaulding, yes. Commissioner Dickey?
Yes.
Commissioner Pulverinti?
Yes.
Commissioner Ding?
Yes.
And Commissioner Vella? Yes. And Commissioner Mullen?
Yes.
Unanimous with one abstention?
Okay, so approval for file number PLP 17-004 for project description, zone change for MR, and use permit for 1 acre of outdoor cannabis cultivation. Okay, file number UPC 19-002. This one is project use permit for 28,560 square feet of outdoor cannabis cultivation, 5,000 square feet of indoor wholesale cannabis nursery, 10,000 square feet of mixed light greenhouse, totaling 1 acre of cannabis canopy area and 9,640 square feet of propagation and vegetative production area, and 5,000 square feet of processing space under CSCF LLC. This application also includes a separate 20,000 square feet of centralized cannabis processing within a barn under GDCF LLC. I think I could probably stop there. That is the big one of these three. So do I have any comments before we go through on a motion?
I have a question.
Yes.
Is GDFC still the operant term here? Could we get that corrected for the record, please?
If you could use the microphone.
Yeah, so the corporate names are CSCF, Cat, Sam, Cat, Frank, and the other corporate name is WWCMC, Willy Wonka's Chocolate, Cannabis Manufacturing Company.
Thank you. So that replaces GDCF in the record.
Yes, I believe
so.
Yes.
Thank you for that correction.
Okay.
You may be seated. Okay, yes, Commissioner Martin, did you have comments about?
You're asking for a motion?
I am asking for a motion, but I'm also asking if anyone has any comments or anything before we make a motion so we don't run into what we had last time. Okay. Yes, Commissioner Martin.
I move that approval on condition that CEQA approves the projects, and that metered water reports be filed with the Sonoma Valley Groundwater Sustainability Agency and PRMD.
Thank you. Do I have a second for that motion?
I second.
Thank you, Commissioner Ding. All right, so once again, a roll call vote.
Commissioner Freeman. He's thinking. Shall I come back to you?
If you would, please.
Commissioner Curley.
Yes.
Commissioner Keezer.
Return, please.
Chairman Lely.
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Spalding, yes. Commissioner Dickey?
Yes.
Commissioner Pulvarenti?
Yes.
Commissioner Ding?
Yes.
Commissioner Vella? My sense is that they don't change anything. They're required by law anyway. If we move approval, recommending approval, that'll happen. But we have, okay, thank you. So can I continue with roll call? So Commissioner Vella. And Commissioner Mullen.
Yes.
And coming back to Commissioner Friedman.
Yes.
And coming back to you.
Yes.
Hi, neighbor. Okay, thank you. So that was a unanimous approval.
Okay, so file number UPC 19-002 has been approved. And thank you for the clarification on those requirements. They were required to begin with for the application to be approved. I should have mentioned that. I apologize. Okay. I won't. All right, so moving forward. File number UPC 17-0048, applicant named Terra Luna Farms. This is for the request for use permit for 43,560 square foot outdoor cannabis cultivation project on 26.15 acre property, zone land intensive agriculture. The application includes an area of up to 10,000 square feet for propagation and vegetative space, fenced separately from cultivation canopy. Any conversation before motion?
Going back to the comments made on the prior motion, I don't imagine there's anything in law whatsoever to prove, says that the Groundwater Sustainability Commission should receive any reports. I don't know where the metered reports go. I make the assumption that Commissioner Vella was right, that they probably do go to PRMD, but I don't know. Mr. Carr?
That is where they go.
Okay. And the question of CEQA is accurate if it either approves or doesn't approve.
That also is, that action to approve the CEQA document is made by the either the Board of Zoning Adjustments or the Board of Supervisors, depending on who makes the final decision on the project. So those decisions are made together.
All right. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you for that clarification.
I will move that we pass the...
Okay. All right. So do I have a second for the motion?
Second.
Okay. Mr. Freeman, thank you. Shall we go ahead one more time? Let's do this one more time.
Dun, da, da, da. We're getting good at this. Okay, no, we're not. Freeman?
Yes.
Curley?
Yes.
Keezer?
Yes.
Laley?
Yes.
Thomas Martin?
Yes.
Spalding, yes. Dickey?
Yes.
Pulvarenti?
Yes.
Ding?
Yes.
Vella?
Yes.
And last but not least, Commissioner Mullen?
Yes.
Thank you. Again, a
unanimous vote. Okay. So file number UPC 17-0048 has been approved as well. Thank you guys for taking the time to give this presentation. I know it's been a long time coming, and we appreciate all your hard work. If we are going to continue on our meeting, you guys are more than welcome to stay here or leave if you choose to. Please feel free to do so now if you
It's really fun.
If you're so moved. No, we have more to go. Okay, these next ones. Okay, so agenda item number 8, the election of the chair for 2020, not 2019. Yes, although we did not meet much in 2019. So I could see why that was put in there. So do we have a nomination for chair?
I would like to nominate Ryan Laley for the chair position.
I have a second. All right. Okay. I'm flattered. It's hot in here. That's why I'm blushing. I'm flattered again. All in favor of that motion?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone abstain or nays? Any nays? Seeing none. Okay. I'm 3 years in a row, and I promise we'll meet more this year. The agenda was a little light last year. Okay, so moving on to number 9, election of the vice chair for 2020.
I'd like to nominate our esteemed current vice chair, Tim Freeman.
I would second that nomination. Okay. All in favor of that nomination?
Aye.
Aye. Any nays? Seeing none. Okay. Congratulations, sir. You are once again the vice chair. I see where this is going. Okay, so agenda item number 10, election of secretary for 2020. I nominate Commissioner Spaulding for second by Commissioner Kieser. All in favor?
Aye.
Any nays? Seeing none. Congratulations. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, so there we go. Here we are again, everyone. Thank you for your faith and trust. Oh, yes, yes, Marie. The second was Commissioner Kieser. Okay, but we're not done yet, everyone. Agenda item number 11. So consideration of items for future agenda. We have the Springs SPP or SSP at some point coming towards us and the Winery Working Group, if I'm not mistaken. Any other items that people have on their forefront of their brain? Yes.
Thank you. I would like to recommend that we take up the recommendations given at the beginning of the meeting tonight regarding SDC and the urban growth boundary in Sonoma that Terry Shore presented to us. Both of them represent opportunities for us to learn more and be perhaps better representatives of our community. So does that...
Yeah, I believe
Pat's
there's...
Pat's going to tell us why we...
Yeah, I want to, you know, the four data project cities, UGB, because this is purely City of Sonoma voters issue. So usually we generate an agenda for each on the meeting because, and this time, I would suggest either the you as a chair contact with the Cafe Capilio and see if that is okay, because that is a city of Sonoma and a county of Sonoma. It's joint and the commission.
So,
is that right?
Yes, your joint powers agreement here. So this is jointly City of Sonoma and the County of Sonoma. What I would recommend on the UGB, absolutely reach out to the city manager. She is aware. I've brought her into the email conversation I've had with Terry Shore that Terry would like to have that here, and I've not heard back from her. But definitely, if it's going to be on the ballot, it must only be educational. There cannot be any urging of folks to think one way or the other. So I'd certainly encourage you to have somebody from the city here. So that, because they're probably the ones charged with the educational information on that. So you might want to do some homework on that. And definitely you have city appointees who might be able to do that. And you have Councilmember Cook here, liaison, so you could certainly chat with him as well as how best to do that. But as I said, just be very, very careful because it's going to be on the agenda. So it can't be political. It can only be educational. On the SDC, what they're putting together on the STC is a PAT. It's not named after me. But the PAT is going to act somehow like the TAC did for the Spring Specific Plan. They look at that as an arm of Permit Sonoma so that they can kind of wrangle things and get stuff together. They have every intention of working through SVCAC. So you all not be left out of the process You're just not in the process at this very early stage. So.
Yes, Ms. Pulverinti.
Adding on to Margaret's comment, that meeting with the Sonoma City Council and Planning Commission is Monday night. And for those of you that are available, I think it would be a great idea to be here to see the dialogue that's going on.
And if I'm not mistaken, it's at the Vintage House.
Yeah.
Vintage House, not here. Yeah,
that is the six o'clock. Yeah, 6 o'clock.
Okay. Mr. Martin, did you have
something? Well, yeah. The urban growth boundary issue is, while its impact is immediately upon the city, there are great reverberations and effects that do affect areas outside, obviously. And so I would think that in any dialogue that the effect upon the county, upon Glen Ellen, and other regions would be important to bring in. I don't know how we do that and remain non-political, but in any event, I think that has to be done.
That is right. I went back review of the SVCAC. The reason why we set up this kind of advisory commission, joint between the city and the county, one of the major tasks is protecting the open space during this 24 miles from the Maritana to all the way down to the San Pablo Bay. That is the major reason. That is in the 1993, they started a concern about this. So that definitely, if anybody out in a group and then have the time, at least to go over there, to listen, and hopefully support, because also this is a part of our mission. And, thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Yes, please.
I promise this is the last one. So I didn't realize that the decision had been made that this is going to go for the vote. I didn't. About so the urban growth boundary.
So you all are venturing way into the Brown Act here. This is not on your agenda tonight.
Okay. Sorry.
We've already had a commissioner member recommend supporting it.
Okay.
So I would say you should probably stop this discussion. Okay.
My apologies, Pat. It's been a long time since I've sat up here. Are you guys still sure you want me as chair? My apologies. Yes, I should have caught that. So we're not going to talk about that anymore, everyone. All right. So moving on, item 12, adjourn. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
A motion to adjourn.
All in favor? Aye. All right. Thank you, everyone. Good to see you. We'll see you next month.